This is Richmond International Raceway, and as one driver put it, Saturday night at a short track, what could be better? Welcome to the Chevy American Revolution Free Race Show. Racing from Richmond on FX is straight ahead.
It's going to be one wild ride on a Saturday night.
And it's all going to come to the checkered flag here in a couple more laps.
This is going to get interesting.
Welcomes you back to Richmond, the place where America gathers every weekend for NASCAR. Nice to have you along with us. Drivers being introduced, getting ready to go racing, along with our team. Let's introduce from the Hollywood Hotel, Darrell Waltrip, Jeff Hamlin, Chris Myers. Glad you could join us here on FX for Saturday night short track racing. So hot tempers, a hot time.
Hey, some of the best fights I've ever seen. Saturday night at a racetrack.
At rivalries.
Right. A lot of rivalries right now. And we keep talking about, hey, you don't want to bring a knife to a gunfight. And this is one of those places you better be ready.
The buzz across the country today was about the last lap and how it ended in the Busch race here on Friday night. Elliott Sadler, the hometown Virginian, trying to win it with a flat tire. And look at Carl Edwards work Elliott Sadler for the victory. It was the only lap that Carl Edwards in the 60 car led, but it was the most important, the victorious backflip. And afterwards, you see Brad Parrott.
That's just ugly.
Yeah, his brother's also the crew chief.
Right.
For Elliott Sadler, obviously, so they're still hot and bothered.
You see those two guys right, got out of the race car. I mean, Carl went down there to try to talk to Elliott, and he didn't want to hear nothing about it.
Yeah, now, but Elliott was a gentleman about it. He was a real Southern.
Right, was that a bad move or not?
He locked that jaw. I talked to Elliott Sadler. He said, look, I wouldn't have done that to Carl Edwards, but if that's how he races, everybody here saw that, and so that's how they'll race him.
Hey, what did he do to the one car, my friend? How did he get the lead?
Well, I'm not condoning it either way.
Would you have done that?
Yes.
Okay, so see, you got to do what you have to do to win.
It's racing. It's different than it used to
be. I saw Elliott at the driver's meeting, and he said, it's over. I'm racing for a championship. So do you think there'll be any retaliation? We also have the Jeff Green, Michael Waltrip saga.
You got to remember, last night was not for points as far as Elliott Sadler was concerned. He was trying to win a race. Carl Edwards is trying to get points. Tonight, they're both in the same battle. So I think they would race each other a little differently tonight. But, hey, man, we've seen some real racing and rubbing here lately.
But don't drop your guard. If I'm Carl Edwards, every time I get around that number 38 car, you better be on guard.
In terms of the points, the championship points, Elliott Sadler, the driver with the most points, who has yet to win this season. And there is Carl Edwards, who's also, he's the leader in Busch points. He's trying to work his way up in Cup points. Jimmy Johnson has led for the last seven races. His teammate, Jeff Gordon, second. Defending points champ, Kurt Busch, fourth. 15 drivers within that range of the chase for the Nextel Cup. And Kurt Busch, a little bit hot last week, throwing the water bottle. No fine, but got a warning.
Yeah, he did. And yesterday, I thought it was funny. He was up in the tower last night, actually, watching the Busch race from the NASCAR tower on a headset, listening to how they ran the race, how they determined how they were going to do what they did.
And Chris, right here, the Chevy drivers to watch tonight are going to be Jimmy Johnson, Jeff Gordon, and Tony Stewart, who has three wins at this racetrack. Keep an eye on these guys.
There's Tony Stewart, who has yet to win a race this year. Joe Gibbs had a pre-race meeting with the head coach at Virginia Tech. Will Ferrell's movie Kicking and Screaming opened this weekend, and I thought that was a description of Kurt Busch, actually, on pit road. But actually, it's drivers reacting when they don't win NASCAR's Sexiest Driver Contest. During last week's race, Jimmy Johnson was overheard telling crew chief Chad Knaus about his loss to Michael Waltrip in the contest, and I can't believe I lost to this guy. Let's check out this week.
But Michael Waltrip's taller.
Thanks, Chris. Well, we had another record-breaking week, getting more than 800,000 votes. Fan fave Dale Earnhardt Jr. beat Tony Stewart with 53% of the votes. And now number 8's the first member of our Final Four. Way to go. This week's matchup pits veteran Dale Jarrett and his rugged good looks against hot young stud Casey Kane. This should be a good one. Be sure to vote. It's so easy. Just log on to foxsports.com, powered by MSN. Keyword sexiest. Don't you move. We'll be right back.
I'm Morgan.
Nice to have you with us. It's the Chevy American Revolution 400 here on FX. We might have our own revolution the way things are going here at the Hollywood Hotel. Rusty Wallace's last call tour continuing at Richmond. His 6 wins, the most by any active driver. He'd love to win lucky number 7 tonight. We'll be watching closely. Rusty, nice enough to join us from down on the track, ready to go racing live. Thanks for being with us, Rusty. You're starting from row 4 tonight. What can we expect?
You can expect a great race tonight, no doubt about it. I got
Russell,
what do you want, D-Dub?
Dude, I was watching TV this week. You go up to New York and you're about to kill a guy on a go-kart. What's up with
this? This is Tony Danza.
I was just glad to be on the show. I didn't mean to hurt him. I just gave him a little bump and run, and he got in that gravel, and that tire was in front of him, and he turned it over. I couldn't believe it. I've been nervous before, but that's about as nervous as I've been.
The Daytona 500, you flipped him out. We have a little surprise for you, Rusty.
What is it?
Live from New York. The guy that you spun out, Tony, is seeking his revenge, I believe. Dan's in distress. Tony?
Rusty, I'm just here to wish you good luck tonight, Rusty.
Well, hey, how's your head, Tony? Is your head doing okay?
I'm okay, Rusty. You know, I really realize now something. It's a pattern with you. It's a pattern. I saw this thing about your own partner, your own teammate you're having problems with. It's a pattern. I know now.
I had a little problem with my teammate. I don't have nothing against you, though. Everything's all right.
No, but Rusty, I think what happened
I got Biffle right here next to me. He's been good to me, too. He gave me a little break last week.
Can we get him for you?
I got the hottest guy on the circuit with me now, Tony.
I think he knocked you
Hey,
conscious.
Rusty.
Yeah.
He dropped
Rusty,
everybody
we never
like
got,
that, Tony.
I never got so much press. I have to kill somebody to get that much press.
It was Rusty almost did. How come you didn't wear a helmet, Tony?
Because Rusty didn't want to wear one because his NASCAR buddies would have made fun of him. That's why.
See,
and if he wasn't wearing one,
hey,
I would.
Now he's telling you the truth. That's the truth. We didn't wear a helmet because Tony said, hey, that looks stupid. We're not wearing helmets. You know, we're tough guys.
So they told me,
look, Tony's going to drive hard. He's not going to give you a break. And so I gave him a little bump and run. Man, I never thought he'd turn over. I mean,
you're full of baloney. You knew.
It's rivalry Saturday night.
Let me tell you what, buddy. You think that was rough? You watch this thing tonight, buddy.
I know. Let me tell you something. I'm listening to you guys. I'm not sure it's the contender or NASCAR. It sounds like a fight. I don't believe this.
Don't feel bad, Tony.
Yeah.
He backed into me the same way over Charlotte one time.
Yeah, but
it's a pattern.
For? Yeah, but I got $200,000 out of your deal.
Well, what'd you get from Tony?
You got a lot of press out of mine. It's a pattern, Rusty. It's a pattern, Rusty. It's a pattern. Give it up.
Can you believe all this trash
give
talking?
Give it up.
All this trash talking. He's roughing me up right now.
I've
got to get him in one of these cars one day, and I'll do the driving. He can do the riding, and we'll wake his butt up. I'll tell you that.
All right, we got to wrap Tony.
Hey, Rusty. I'm shaking.
You need to be, pal.
All right, Tony forced Rusty into retirement.
Good luck tonight, Rusty.
Hey, man, I'm glad
good
you're okay,
tonight.
Dude.
All right,
thanks.
I'm
scary,
fine.
Man.
Go get him
killed
tonight.
You. I'm glad you're okay.
All right, thanks, Rusty.
I'm
thanks,
fine.
Tony.
Go get him.
Now we know who's the boss.
Okay, guys.
I appreciate you being
Chris.
With us. Okay.
We'll talk to you later.
All right,
out of control here.
I heard they didn't want to wear helmets because they didn't want to mess up their hair. That's what
okay.
Tony Danza's show on during the afternoon, of course, and he was certainly having a good time. All right, let's talk a little bit more about tonight's race. Can you update me on the Michael Waltrip, Jeff Green discrepancy? Did Michael deserve more punishment than what he got last week for that one lap penalty?
I talked to Michael about that, and I told him, I said, dude, let's don't do that anymore. That's that was unnecessary. You don't take aggression out on the racetrack, and particularly all night long. I was somewhat felt sorry for both of them.
Hey, cut the chase.
My brother.
He should have been parked, and you know it.
He should have been parked.
Wow,
Jeff Hammond, your old crew chief buddy, just hanging you out there.
If that had been my race car, I'd say parking.
I tell you what I told him. I said, you better hope the king don't get up
That's
in your
right.
face.
Get that finger being that, right. like that.
In this race tonight, caution comes out late. We always keep it. You taking two tires or four tires?
Say, Darlington, what are you asking a question like that for?
Track position is important.
Track position is important, I think, tonight. You've got to be real, real careful not to be kind of lulled into that right there. Four tires are good, but we saw last night Clint Bowyer had a fast race car, came in and got tires late, never got back to the front.
Yeah, that was a bad move on his part. I think I'd take two. If I was trying to get back out and get me some track position and have a shot at winning, I think I'd probably take two. And this is not a bad tire. Doesn't fall off that much. So I'd probably take two and hope for the best.
All right, Jeff Gordon trying to win his fourth race this year. Casey Kane, he had the pole in the Busch race. He has the pole tonight. He's up front with Ryan Newman. That, of course, Rusty's a partner who has mentioned. Dodge hasn't won a cup race yet this year.
Yeah, they've got to work. You know what's affecting all these cars? And what's making all these cars run so close together is one simple thing, the gear rule. They don't have passing gear. Last year here, they ran like a 543 gear. That's a really low gear. This year, they're at a 514 maximum. They don't have that zip off the corner to get up under a guy and pass him. So they're all just running around there in a wad. They can't go anywhere.
Sound effects on Saturday night. All right, the man on the pole, as we mentioned, Casey Kane, still in search of his first cup win after six second-place finishes. What's that noise again?
One more time.
Okay. But Casey came in first when he sat down with me for 10 laps with.
If you could beat out one person at the finish line to win a race, who would it be?
Tony Stewart.
Why is that?
Just be nice to beat him to the finish line. He's tough to beat to the finish line. It'd be nice to beat him.
What's your favorite dessert?
Ice cream, vanilla ice cream, caramel on top.
Okay. What are you most proud of?
Most proud of my family.
If you had to describe your personality behind the wheel of the car versus outside the car, how would you?
A lot more aggressive behind the wheel, you know, a lot more laid back and, you know, just kind of let things go off the when I'm not behind the wheel.
Finish this statement for me. I am most nervous when?
I'm going out on my first date.
Okay, we're going to try a little word association, 10 laps. Ready? Okay. Rain delays.
Boring.
Rupees.
Everywhere.
Rookie.
Learning.
Tattoos.
No.
Marriage.
Good. Bad.
It does have a lot of that in it. You're right.
See, already the indecision. How about he said most?
Marriage will do that. Good, bad, I don't know.
Good, bad, he forgot the ugly, didn't he?
Most nervous, he said, but his first date. He should worry about the last date, too. You usually get pretty nervous then. We wish Casey a lot of luck tonight. Also want to remind everyone that this week is National Transportation Week, which provides and promotes transportation safety to everyone. In addition, Chevy, what are you guys looking at? Chevy has its own initiatives as part of their long-term commitment to passenger safety. I could use some safe help right now.
10 totally new cars and trucks, a completely re-engineered showroom in less than 2 years' time. This is why we say the new Chevrolet is an American revolution. Hi, I'm Ed Pieper, the general manager of Chevrolet, and along with Jeff Burton and our entire team of Chevrolet dealers, it is our honor to be tonight's title sponsor. From the new Cobalt to the sixth generation Corvette, these cars and trucks are pure Chevrolet.
Of course, I rely on Chevy to do my job on the track, but I also rely on Chevy for my family's transportation. So the safety built into these cars and trucks is as important to me on the highway as it is on the high-banked oval.
In fact, no automotive brand offers more technology to protect you before, during, and after an incident than Chevrolet. We're teaming with our friends at the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, urging everyone to buckle up and save lives.
Ed and I would ask you to remember a few important things. Don't drink and drive, and please be sure everyone is buckled up properly every trip, every time.
Enjoy tonight's Chevy American Revolution 400 and have a great and safe summer.
When I was young.
The Chevy American Revolution 400 is brought to you by Chevy, who reminds you to buckle up America, an American revolution. FX welcomes you to Richmond, a sellout crowd of more than 100,000 set for stars in cars on a track that produces speed and spikes. We'll see if Dale Earnhardt Jr., who won this race last year, can beat back, among others, Tony Stewart, Kurt Busch, and the driver with the Hollywood name Casey Kane. Dale Earnhardt Jr. hoping for his first win this year. The Chevy American Revolution 400 on Fox. Let's head down trackside for opening ceremony.
Ladies and gentlemen, will you please rise and remove your hats as the Color Guard with the Non-Commissioned Officers Academy at Fort Lee presents our nation's colors. And now please welcome Viola Jackson as she leads us in the Pledge of Allegiance, followed by the invocation delivered by Reverend Joe Ellison of the Essex Village Community Church.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Her debut album, Traveling Light, will be in stores the first week of June. Please welcome Island Def Jam recording artist and NASCAR fan, Courtney J.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there.
Flyover here at Richmond, Virginia. The voices of NASCAR on Fox, Darrell Waltrip, Larry McReynolds, and Mike Joy to call tonight's race here on FX. Mike?
Oh, would you settle for two out of three? Darrell's going to join us here in just a second, but thanks, Chris. And hi, everybody. Last night in the NASCAR Busch Series race, we saw many different strategies as drivers tried to pit, contrary strategy to when other drivers pit, so they would maximize their track position and things would cycle through. Larry, do you expect that kind of race tonight?
Well, I do, and you know, sometimes we get caught up in what happened last week. Yeah, there was no question. Last week at Darlington, you wanted four tires every time that caution came out. But I think tonight, you'll see guys trying to get off sequence with each other and hope that you have good enough tires toward the end that you can make it to the end and still outrun the competition. It's just like Jeff Hammond pointed out. I've seen this a lot, where
pit strategy can win a race, but in the case of Clint Bowyer last night, who clearly had the best car, I think pit strategy actually lost the race.
All right, late race caution. Darrell said he'd like two tires. What would you want to give him?
It all depends on if I have a good handling car. If you've got a good handling car and you don't have that many laps to go to the end, maybe so, but you know what? This is a short track race, and you know you're going to have to lean on people and maneuver around. Hard to beat those four tires.
I hate it depends. I'd want to stay out. Chris?
Well, we want to invite fans, Mike and Larry, to participate in the singular virtual crew chief during today's race, tonight's race. Stay tuned for details on how you can play. Watch for your chance to drive away in your own singular 31 car. Crowd anxious to go. There is some threatening weather in the area, so the start of the race moved up just a bit. But we're all ready to go racing here on FX.
Welcome back to Richmond International Raceway, this D-shaped three-quarter mile short track that has shown us such action in the past and will again tonight. Here's the Chevy starting grid. Casey Kane, Ryan Newman, the front row in Dodges. Tony Stewart's the first Chevy in the race. He starts third alongside Kurt Busch. Let's go down to that starting grid and join Matt Yoakum.
Mike, a lot of eyes will be back a little deeper in the grid. Dale Earnhardt Jr. starts 27 tonight. 1-2 night race, short track races last year, looking for a win this year. Now keep one thing in mind, points wise, the last six races, he's gone from 27 tonight to 9th. Could be a big points race for him tonight, especially if you look at past history. Over the last 2.5 years, he has averaged per short track race more points than any other driver. 2 wins in the last 2.5 years. And he's got a lot of success right here on this three-quarter mile bull ring. He expects more tonight. Mike?
Thanks, Matt. The lady who gave the Pledge of Allegiance lost her daughter, PFC Leslie Jackson, a year ago, giving her life for her country. So nice to have her here tonight.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, would you please welcome Ed Pieper, Chevrolet General Manager, as he delivers those most famous words in motorsports.
Are you ready for an American Revolution? Gentlemen, start your engines!
Set to go racing short track Saturday night. Let's join the executive editor of Speedway Illustrated, Dick Berggren.
Thanks, Mike. 25-year-old Casey Kane, right behind me here, has never won a Nextel Cup race. He's had fast cars, winning 6 poles, including the pole for tonight's race. And he's come close. 6 times he's finished second, sometimes by as little as 1.5 inches to the guy that eventually won the race. He's won in midgets, Silver Crown cars. He's won in sprint cars, Busch Series cars, even in the Craftsman Truck Series. He has a very fast car in race trim, and tonight he hopes to become a winner in the Nextel Cup Series for the very first time.
Thanks, Dick. Getting set to go here at Richmond, when there'll be a lot of people tonight wondering who spun me around.
NASCAR on FX is brought to you by Nextel, by Napa Auto Parts, by TGI Fridays, and by Coca-Cola.
The pace laps begin, the flash bulbs explode all around this three-quarter mile as dusk descends. It was a hot day today. Air temperatures in the 90s. The track temperature reflects that. But there is rain moving into the area. There's a big storm system off to the west. It's headed this way, and we hope not too soon. So we've moved the start of this race up a few minutes as a precaution. Let's go down to the pit of last week's winner with Steve Burns.
Yeah, Mike, I'm just kind of catching up on some last second reading. You see, Greg Biffle's on the front of the USA Today sports page. After 10 races a year ago, he was 23rd in points. Now, after 10 races in 2005, he is third, coming off his third win of the 2005 Nextel Cup season. He's also trying to become the third driver in consecutive years to win the Nextel Cup championship for Jack Roush, and the first driver to win three championships in all three of NASCAR's premier divisions, NASCAR Craftsman Trucks, the Busch Series, and now the Nextel Cup.
Thanks, Steve. Darrell Waltrip joins us up top to call tonight's race. We may all disagree of what to do on the final pit stop, but I think we all agree on how to get to the final pit stop based on what we saw last night. You got to stay out in front of all this, and the way Turn 2 raced last night, that's not going to be easy.
No, it didn't, and nobody's really got a handle on this joint lately. You know, we've had seven different winners in the last seven races here, so it's been kind of hit and miss for a lot of these teams, but that is one thing we know. Strategy, tire strategy at the end of the race, like we saw last week, will have an effect on the outcome of this race.
So, Larry, pit strategy being off sequence, will that keep you out front?
Yes, it will, and there's no question. When you base it on last night and races here in the past, out front is the place to be. But even though it's cooling down, it's nighttime, this racetrack is much hotter than it was yesterday. I think we're going to have some ill-handling cars that need some early race adjustments.
Ill-handling cars, ill-handling tempers. Ooh.
Oh, not that again. All right, back down for to the check-in desk at the Hollywood Hotel.
Thanks, Mike. A last driver to win a cup race in a backup car was Greg Biffle. Ryan Newman on the front row is in a backup car.
Yeah, he's in a backup car, but we've already seen early this year that Greg Biffle won in Texas in a backup car. So these guys have got a really good race car. They got it up front because they did all the repairs necessary to get that backup car ready to go, introduced it before qualifying, and NASCAR says everything's okay, boys, so he's able to stay up on the front row.
Last pole sitter to win here, Bill Elliott, 92. Casey Kane on the pole, trying to win his first race. Mike?
Look at this crowd, Chris, as we have a look at the Nextel Cup Series points. Jimmy Johnson on top of his Hendrick teammate, Jeff Gordon. Greg Biffle climbs to third. Kurt Busch drops to fourth this week. Elliott Sadler, it's his home track. And there is the cutoff point, Jeremy Mayfield. If the chase ended today, as it will in September here at Richmond, or the race to the chase, Mayfield would be the last in within that magic 400-point gap to the leader. Now, let's have a look at the 390-horsepower Chevy SSR pace vehicle. Looking back at Casey Kane and Ryan Newman.
And we hope it's not as busy as it was last night.
Right. Look at this crowd, 27th consecutive sellout at Richmond International Raceway.
There you see pit road speed, 40 miles per hour. That fuel pit window, 110 to 120 laps could always be a factor. DW, it's Saturday night. That's all right for fighting. Reach up there, pull those belts tight one more time.
Yeah, baby.
Boogity, boogity, boogity. Let's go racing, boys.
To the trouble spot last night, advantage Casey Kane. Here comes Stewart on the inside for second, and Kurt Busch on the bottom. Stewart for the lead on lap one, doesn't get it.
Casey Kane will get those 5 points early.
I think you'll see good action, good side-by-side racing in three and four. They're gonna have to really be careful in turns one and two for a while. And as you can see, coming off turn four or two over there now, Elliott Sadler got up high, and he's bottlenecked up that whole crowd.
He was almost above that second groove, and he almost had to just stop the car.
And then you pick up all that little bit of dirt and debris on your tires. It takes a lap or so to get it burned back off.
Three wide in the corner. Sadler outside of Jeff Burton and the 19 of Mayfield.
And he will get freight trained, Mike. He may end up back in 40th place before he can actually get his car back under control and get in line. And you're looking at the car there, the 38 car, that's had the most success on the other two short track races this year. He's accumulated the most points.
He started up in the fifth position. Now in just three laps, he's back to 16th.
Look at him, Larry. I mean, he just got nowhere to go. I mean, it's all just like he got a flat tire.
And he came in here with so much confidence after that second place run last night in the Busch race.
But where did he lose that race? Turn two. Carl Edwards got into it, and Sadler could have been a little gun shy there at turn two, but I doubt it. He's a racer, and he wants to win here. Worst of all, it's his home track.
Well, maybe he's trying to clean that groove off early tonight so that won't happen again.
Kevin Harvick on the move, moves up to fifth, staring down Ryan Newman, who started second.
Kevin, just getting a good run.
Well, I think you can see already, Mike, how everybody's tried to get into single file here and not do any real serious side-by-side racing at this point.
Sixth place, Ricky Rudd, for whom this is also his home racetrack, trying to hold off Rusty Wallace.
And you heard Richard Childers. He was talking to Kevin Harvick there on the radio. Get in your rhythm, and that's what you're trying to do right now. Just get in your rhythm, start hitting your marks. Let's get some laps behind us.
And this is a rhythm racetrack.
Our points leader, Jimmy Johnson, back at 24th position. The number 48, the Lowe's Chevy. Heavy traffic just ahead.
And there you see Elliott Sadler, though, right in front of him, the 38 car. You can just tell, Darrell, even right now he's trapped on the outside, but I was watching him earlier. He cannot turn that car to the bottom of the racetrack.
No, he's just he's stuck out there, and right now he says, okay, I'm stuck out here. I'm going to make the best of it and wait for something to happen. Hope it doesn't happen to me.
Most of the three wide here. Johnson on the outside of that's Dave Blaney in the middle, and wisely Mike Bliss gets on the brake, and that allows Sterling Marlin, that's silver number 40, to close in. Biffle, Rusty, an inch apart.
Battle for seventh position.
Wallace trying to make the outside work here off turn two.
As long as that guy on the inside will take care of you and not get into you, you can manage that okay. But boy, I tell you, you got to be careful.
I've been watching the car right behind them. Johnny Sauter in the 09 car had a great qualifying run. Started in 13th, great run in the Busch race last night. I think he's a little quicker than those guys, but right now they have him boxed in.
Well, that's I don't know if that's the same car they had at Phoenix or not, but he had a top 10 finish at Phoenix in that car and was the best Dodge all night long.
Yes, he was.
Most of the cautions in last night's Busch race were a case of either somebody getting under a car in turn two and slipping up into it, or getting too wide down into turn three and the outside car squeezing down. And just cases of two race cars, not enough space.
And that would also, you could define that as no give and take.
I tell you what, Larry, we watched Tony Stewart in practice and qualifying. It's one of his best qualifying runs since I think I read Kansas City in 03. And he's up here leading the race tonight. He loves this racetrack. He's won here in everything just about he's driven here. Trucks, Busch cars, and Cup. I even ran out. Did he not run an IRL car here?
Yeah, he got his very first career win here in 1999. He did it by leading over three-fourths of the race.
Tony Stewart has led 12 of 13 laps in Richmond. 21 laps in, and Tony Stewart still holds a half-second advantage on Casey Kane, Kurt Busch, and the new fourth-place car is Kevin Harvick. Ryan Newman in fifth, Ricky Rudd, Rusty Wallace, Greg Biffle, and Jeremy Mayfield. Johnny Sauter has slipped back to 10th place.
And watching Kevin Harvick, you see right there, he's moved up about a half a lane, and over about the last 10 laps, he has had one of the faster race cars.
Yeah, I think, Larry, three and four, no question. You're going to make a lot more time up high around three and four once that groove gets good up top. But you just got to be so cautious in one and two not to jump, as the dirt track guys would say, the cushion down there.
Well, it looks like what he can do by running that little up higher groove, he can drive the car in the corner and the car will turn.
Yeah, and the other thing, Larry, again, just referring back to what I said in the pre-race show about the gear rule, one of the things that all these teams are struggling with, a lot of the teams are struggling with, is they're not turning 10,000 RPM here like they did last year. And that has really messed up their engine combination. That's one of the things I believe has really affected DEI. So to run the car a little higher and run it a little freer, it'll go a little faster.
Just remember, Kevin Harvick was one of those 16 Nextel Cup drivers that was in the Busch race last night. See, Johnny Sauter in the 09. That car's starting to go backwards just a little bit as Kyle Busch in the 5 moves on, and this is a battle for 10th right now.
They're going to move past Mike Garvey's slow car on the bottom of the racetrack. He had come down pit road, but apparently missed his pit. He's going to have to come back in again.
leader, Tony Stewart, the 20 car. He's about to catch the tail end of the field here in lap 26. He'll be in lap traffic, which could be a big advantage for Casey Kane in the 9, Kurt Busch in the 97, and Kevin Harvick in the 29.
One of the things, Larry, I'm looking at as I look at the racetrack is the rubber buildup that the track is showing. That is so dark and black in the groove, and that's nothing but rubber. And there goes the 16 trying to get by Rusty, and does, Biffle. Looks like Jeremy is trying to stick a nose in there.
See what, I've been watching Jeremy Mayfield in the 19 car. He started back in the 15th position. Remember, he won the race here in September, and that win catapulted him in to the chase for the cup. Looks like both of the Ray Evernham cars, Casey Kane in the 9 and Jeremy Mayfield, have good cars tonight.
Here's Kane. Kane has closed the gap on Tony Stewart. It's down to just 0.3 seconds, Jeff.
Got a chance to talk to Ray Evernham, owner of both these cars, the 9 of Kane, as well as Mayfield. And he told me, Larry, that they had really worked on putting a tunable setup underneath these cars, that the testing they've been doing lately, and they really felt like that they were starting to understand the balance that this Dodge Charger really needed. And their drivers, as well as their engineers, have been working very close trying to come up with setups that would allow these impound races to make their cars a lot more tunable. He said, early on, we feel like we got the cars where they'll get good grip up off the corners and should be able to make a run towards the front. But as the track changes, they felt like they could keep up with those changes better than they have all year long.
Well, yeah, Jeff, you go back to a very similar racetrack, Phoenix. Neither one of his cars were very good there, and I know they've worked very hard on their flatter track program since Phoenix.
Boy, Greg Biffle is picking up right where he left off last week as he dove underneath and shot past Ricky Rudd. Now Mayfield closes on the Wood Brothers number 21. But Biffle is on the march. He has climbed to sixth.
Again, I just want to point out all that rubber that's, we've only run 31 laps, and there's a ton of rubber already building up outside the groove. And guys told me that that's one of the issues they have up here, getting out of the groove and getting that stuff on the tires. It's like hitting ice.
You see right there how deep Kevin Harvick in the 29 could drive it off in the corner, and he does not give up that much time off the corner. He's all over the back of Kurt Busch in the 97 car. And it sounds like, Darrell, you see Kurt Busch in the 97 got into the outside wall, had to roll out of the throttle, and allowed Kevin Harvick to take that position. But, Darrell, it sounds like even 33 laps into this run, Kevin Harvick pretty much can mat that throttle down right now.
When you run high up here in 3 and 4, you can. You get a nice run off of turn 4, off of turn four there. But it's when you try to pinch it to the bottom, you have to really work the throttle. But just making me nervous running up that higher this early.
Kurt Busch, the defending series champ, spent a couple of laps in the penalty box last week at Darlington for abusive language on the radio and gesture toward a NASCAR official. So last night during the Busch race, Kurt accepted an invitation to watch the race from the NASCAR control tower and see how Joe Ballas, the Busch series director, and David Hoots and the other folks up there called the race from the official's perspective.
And a person in that booth told me, they asked Kurt what he thought. He said, I'm even more confused now than I was.
Dick Bergeron.
Well, Casey Kane riding in second spot. That's Carter 9 right behind Tony Stewart on your screen right now. Car's pushing a little bit, Mike. And for a while, he was running a slightly higher line in the corners than Stewart. But then he has dropped down, running a little bit lower line than Stewart, and has closed on him. The concern from the spotter, they are about to close on a whole pile of traffic, and they want to get through that with all their fenders intact.
Well, just ahead, Scott Riggs and Dale Jarrett, two fellows who don't want to go a lap down this early in the race if they can avoid it. Stewart's there, but there's nowhere to go.
Boxed in right now.
Riggs gives way, as required to do by the rules. The starter will have that blue flag in hand, and it'll next be waved at Dale Jarrett. Tony takes the low side.
Not putting up a whole really big fight here at this point out of Jarrett's cars. And Riggs's both seem to be off the pace quite a bit compared to what Tony and Casey Kane is running.
And let me clarify, you're not required to slow down for the leader. You're required to give him a lane for his race car, and Jarrett's doing just that. He's giving Stewart the bottom. If you can pass me, pass me.
Yeah, you don't have to move over. That is a warning flag. The leader is behind you. The leader's trying to get by you. It's almost like a courtesy thing. But remember, what goes around comes around.
But look at Kevin Harvick in that 29 car with all this traffic. He's caught Casey Kane, the 9 car, goes to the high side. I think he'll win this battle in the turn one.
But he's got Jarrett just ahead, as you see from Dale's rear bumper. Now Harvick needs to make some room. And he's going to have to slice to the bottom to do it.
That 29 car, he's about as good as Clint Bowyer, the 2 car for Richard Childress Racing, was in the Busch race last night.
Casey Kane, to his credit, gave Harvick plenty of room to move from the top to the bottom of the racetrack on Dale Jarrett. So now that gives Tony Stewart a lead of almost a full second. Nine laps complete this time by leader Tony Stewart in heavy traffic trying to get past Kyle Petty. Kevin Harvick has closed right to Stewart's rear bumper, and Harvick has a look on the outside as Stewart's orange number 20 changes lanes to try to follow Jason Leffler's number 11, who is battling Kyle Petty for position just ahead of the leader.
Yeah, Kyle has actually been able to hold off Tony Stewart pretty well here for the last several laps.
Yeah, Kyle may be able to hold off Tony Stewart. I'm just not sure how much longer Tony Stewart's going to be able to hold off Kevin Harvick in that 29.
Well, I just don't know how much longer Tony's going to hold off maybe getting in a hurry.
Traffic has always been tough here at Richmond, Darrell. Even when this was a half mile, it was a difficult place to pass and especially work lapped cars.
Yeah, well, when you get that thing down on the inside, the guy on the outside can bog you down. And then if he gets under you, he runs you up the hill. So a lap car can hold you up for a long time here, as we're seeing right now.
There's third place Casey Kane in the 9 and Kurt Busch in fourth right on his rear bumper in the Irwin 97.
Not real surprised to see Kurt Busch running good here in the 97 cars. It's the same car he won Phoenix with about 3 weeks ago, and this racetrack's very similar.
Well, he had to race one here last fall, Larry, and he had to stop late for fuel, didn't get it full of fuel.
He's now the third place car. Congratulations to Busch's team, led by Jimmy Fennick. They won $100,000 Monday night in the Pit Crew National Championship, powered by Tyson up in Race City, USA, Mooresville, North Carolina. Great job by the Crew Chief Club in putting on that event.
And here goes Harvick.
Their fans had a big time with it as Kevin Harvick takes the lead for the first time tonight. He's the race's third different leader.
And that's all because Tony got down under the 4 car, Mike Wallace there, and got sideways off of turn 2. And Kevin had the momentum and was able to make the pass in 3 and 4.
But it looks like now Tony Stewart in the 20 car, he's moved up to that same groove Kevin Harvick in the 29 moved up to. He takes the lead back. Now Kurt Busch in the 97 car won second place.
Yeah, that whole thing, that pass was because the 20 car got in trouble down there.
Steve is in Kurt Busch's pit.
Kurt Busch already thinking ahead, Mike Joy. He just told crew chief Jimmy Fennick, when we pit, let's take air out of all tires. 1 pound out of the left rear, 3/4 pound out of the right front, 1 pound out of the right rear, and a round of bite out to push down the right rear spring. He said, that'll do it. Great feedback from Kurt Busch, the defending series champ.
I'll tell you what, though, Steve, he's pretty good right now because he's all over Kevin Harvick in the 29 for second place.
These three guys, well, actually four, they are having themselves a whale of a race here. And Mike Wallace up in that 4 car is doing what he can do best, and that's hold them up.
Yeah, I was going to say, make that a 5 car battle and put the 4 in it, because he's trying hard to stay on the lead lap, and this time Stewart gets him. Quaker State aerial coverage as we look as dusk begins to descend on Richmond International Raceway.
I give Tony a lot of credit because he used a lot of restraint there racing with Mike Wallace, because Mike was making it hard for him.
Let's have a look further back in the field where Ricky Rudd is now in 12th place in the Motorcraft Ford, just ahead of Jeff Gordon, the number 2 point man.
But Jeff started back in the 20th position. He's moved up to 12th, 13th place, had a 2-hour practice. He lost 30 minutes of that practice because of a penalty from Darlington for being late going through inspection.
I think they're going to have to adjust on his old ride a little bit, though, because he hadn't just blown up through there. He's kind of had to work hard to get to where he is.
Here comes Dave Blaney now in the Bass Pro Shops 07. He's got underneath run. Takes the preferred line, and he's going to move up to 13th, it looks like.
Now behind Blaney, Elliott Sadler, Jamie McMurray, Mark Martin, Johnny Sauter, trying to hold Dale Earnhardt Jr., who is 19th. Matt?
Dale Jr. started 27th, working on the 09 of Johnny Sauter. Now, he has had a lot of communication back and forth with P. Rondeau, his crew chief, dissecting his race car, knows it's not perfect, telling Pete what it is so Pete knows how to fix it.
Here, how we doing? Pete's over on the right front, loose in, tight in the center, loose off. Just got too much rebound in the right front, the left front. We got you.
12 races since his last victory. That was at Phoenix last fall, but on night races, Mike Joy, he has been dominant. The last 8 night races, 7 times he has finished 8th or better, and that includes 2 victories as he dives on the inside again.
And what he's talking about is pinned on the right front. It got so much pull down in the right front shock that it rolls the car down on that spring and makes him almost skip. Makes him turn right almost to get into the corner. The car is so loose. So they're going to have to come off that rebound, Larry. They got adjustments there, and they could do that on a pit stop. Takes a little time, but they could fix it.
Matt Kenseth, the DeWalt 17, moves right on to Junior's rear bumper. He had slid back to about 25th, and now Kenseth is in 20th place, Dick.
Kenseth's problem, Mike, is a lot. Yeah, the 09 just hit the wall. Matt Kenseth, like a lot of other people we're listening to, has a very tight race car. This is the opportunity they will need to adjust it and loosen it up. We've got a caution flag.
Well, it's the first one of the night. Unlike last night, we get 63 laps under our belt before the first caution flag.
Now, that looks like a right front tire problem. One thing we want to watch here tonight is the rotors glowing on these cars. And why we want to watch that is not so much the glowing rotor, but what it's doing to the tire. And you can see there, the tire goes down. The 09, Johnny Sauter, into the fence. That built so much heat in that right front tire, it's easy to blow it out.
You just see it went straight in the wall, and Darrell, that car was going backwards. You almost could say maybe also the car maybe had a hard push to it. The front end was sliding. That magnified the problem. This caution will benefit a lot of people, but who it's really going to benefit is Jimmy Johnson, our points leader, who was about to go a lap down. Steve.
Small adjustment for Kevin Harvick. Little air out of the right front tire, Larry Mack. They have a new front tire changer. Dan Blizzard replacing the injured Jason Palmer. Match.
And Tony Stewart says the 20 car is tight. Shaggy Larson already makes a track bar adjustment as they hit the Lux on the left side. Meanwhile, the 12 of Newman, track bar adjustment as well. His car was tight.
Casey Kane came in so hot, he almost lost it. The car got right out sideways just as he was getting ready to enter the pit. He has the best pit here. Tony Stewart has already beaten him out. Kane is going to be the second car out, however. Picked up a couple of spots on that one, Mike.
Jeremy Mayfield coming out turned a car that was coming into its pit box, and I believe that car was the hapless Johnny Sauter.
Plus, we have a loose tire and wheel. When they find out who that belongs to, they're going to probably have a penalty of going to the tail end along this line. Biggest problem, we had all 33 cars on the lead lap on pit road at one time.
Jeremy got quite a bit of damage to the right front. I don't know if he'll have to come back to pit road. How about it, Matt?
DW also add the 16 of Biffle and the 49 of Schrader. They almost made contact. Close call as the 49 was trying to get into his box. The 16 was trying to leave his.
I'll bet you can guess who stayed out to lead a lap.
Is it Petty?
Yeah, 7 or 8 times this year, Kyle Petty.
Kyle Petty, yeah.
Every time he does it, though, that's five more points.
That's a lot of bonus points in the year.
Attaboy. We're under caution for the first time tonight.
FX, glad to have you here in Richmond, Virginia. Tony Stewart leading for the second time tonight, 71 laps through. We've had 5 lead changes, 4 different leaders. Casey Kane, the pole sitter, Harvick, Kyle Petty, and of course, Tony Stewart, who twice this year has led the most laps in the race. Martinsville, the Daytona 500, but no victory so far to show for it. Casey Kane running second. Jeff Hammond, after that last round of pit stops, some observation.
Well, what I'm seeing right now is Tony Stewart, really, his crew and he both are just doing an outstanding job so far tonight. But a big break, once again, Larry McReynolds talked about it, the fact that Jimmy Johnson right now got a big break because he got an opportunity to come in and work on that race car, make it better. Otherwise, he's going to be lapped down. But we're also taking a look right now at Scott Wimmer. He's got a lot of tire smoke, looks like, coming off maybe the right rear. He's gotten into somebody for sure, but it's really been rubbing. It's a lot of left front. he may have a flat left front tire. Doesn't look good, guys. Got to do something about that.
Time for the singular virtual crew chief question. Jeff will keep an eye on this. Which pit crew member has the most difficult job? Gas man, jack man, or tire changer? I know, Jeff, you have your opinion. To vote, text the word crew to 191 on your singular wireless phone or go to foxsports.com. You'll also be entered for a chance to drive away in your own singular 31 car. Let's rejoin Darrell, Larry, and Mike.
75 laps in, and Tony Stewart on this restart squirted away from the field. He's got a 1 second lead now on Casey Kane.
Okay, this is just the way the race started. Tony got out there, got him a pretty comfortable lead. I think Harvick's got the kind of car, got to run 10, 12, 15 laps, and then it gets going. And so I think Tony's got a fast car on the short run. Looks like the 29 car's got a good car for the long run.
The tire we saw roll across pit road belonged to Mark Martin. However, there was no penalty assessed because that car was knocked across pit road. That tire was by another car, by Mike Bliss's car, either entering or exiting. Thus, it did not get away from the pit crew and no penalty.
Right with Dale Earnhardt Jr. there. He's up to the 16th position after starting back in 27th. I'm sure there was a lot of major adjustments on that car that last pit stop.
And you know, when you start that four back, he and Jeff Gordon both sim right there together, it takes half the night to get track position. I don't care how good a pit crew you got to keep clicking them off till you can get near the front before you can see how good you are.
Mark Martin in the Viagra number six right there with him, then Mike Bliss in the zero, Jeff Green in the 43.
Jeff Green, 43 car, had a great run in that Busch Series race last night. Good top five run all night long.
That was the four car.
Yeah,
the Biagi brothers. Yeah, he did. He had a good run.
Now, Elliott Sadler got up as high as fifth, fell to 23rd in the early going, and now he's rebounded. Remember, he got some dirt and stuff. Loose rubber on his tires, fell back to 23rd. Now he's climbed back up to 10th.
Uh-oh, got a car around on the back straightaway. Looks like Jimmy Johnson in the inside wall. That all started because of Sterling Marlin and Michael Walton.
The Nextel Cup point leader, Jimmy Johnson, came in here 127 ahead of Jeff Gordon, and now he has spun into the fence.
What happened back there is Sterling Marlin got up high coming off of two. Michael run up on him, and he had to check up. Somebody else checked up and ran into the back of Jimmy Johnson. See right here, the 07, he pushes Sterling up the hill. Sterling has to whoa up. Here comes Michael. He has to whoa up. The 77 was down underneath Jimmy Johnson and just got into him, spun around. Let's see how hard he hits. Pretty darn hard.
A lot of damage to that right front.
Yep.
Looked like that 77 got that wiggle off the corner like we've seen so many times here this weekend. Just moved up a little bit right into the left rear of the 48 car.
See, you see that it's an opportunity. Three guys are up the hill and they're slowing down. Oh my gosh, he's wrecked again.
Looks like he's lost the steering too. The car, he can't turn it, so he can't drive it to pit road.
He hit that inside wall again. Look at those black marks. Here he comes.
Just looked like something on the steering broke. You can see the right front turn dead in. You can see it right there. He was running at a pretty high rate of speed, trying to stay on the lead lap.
Guys, looking at it from that angle, to me, it looked like almost like the tie rod in itself broke. And Darrell, you know what happens when that left front just all of a sudden snaps? He just jerks that wheel right out of your hand, and away it goes.
Yeah, that's exactly what it was. He was coming down through there and just kind of going back to the garage. Our pits didn't have that much damage until this.
Two cars already out of the race, Mike Garvey and Morgan Shepherd. So the worst that Johnson could finish would be 41st.
This pulls a lot of boys back within 400 points again.
Oh, it's a long way to Phoenix.
Second caution of the night for point leader Jimmy Johnson.
Time for a Visa race break. Tony Stewart, your leader, under caution here, 85 laps in. But Jimmy Johnson, the points leader, and one of two drivers to finish in the top 10 in both short track races this season, in some trouble. You could see coming in where everybody stood with the points. But with Jimmy's situation and where some other drivers are currently, this is up to the very second. Greg Biffle would be second, Jeff Gordon third. Bottom part of that, you see, as they're getting ready to restart. Jimmy Johnson hoping to get back into the race. Let's rejoin Daryl, Larry, and Mike.
Now, the first 23 cars stayed on the racetrack. Ricky Rudd pitted along with Dale Earnhardt Jr., Joe Nemechek, and the rest of the cars on the lead lap. So, Larry, already we're seeing contrary strategy among the lead lap cars.
Yeah, and those 9 or 10 cars that pitted, they were at the back of the pack anyhow, probably needed more adjustments. But what they would hope is maybe we get about a 20 or 25 lap run here, then some of those guys may stay out if we get a caution.
Yeah, there's way too many cars on the lead lap right now to be taking a chance on getting back in that mess.
Oh, Dale Jarrett took a big slide up and out of the groove, and that stacks things up behind him. Greg Biffle, Jeff Burton, Rusty Wallace, and others. By the way, Scott Riggs got the free pass on that caution. He's back on the lead lap.
Now Dale Jarrett one lap down, back at the 36th position in the UPS car.
And he's right in front of Greg Biffle, and Greg is probably going to get a little irritated here before too long because they're getting away from him up front.
Boy, Biffle in a 16, he drove it down into turn 3 that time.
8 tires are better than 4, and he's getting ready to use all 8 of them.
Hope you're enjoying this short track Saturday night on FX. We'll have nighttime coverage coming at you the rest of the month of May in Nextel Cup.
Casey Kane in that 9 car, he's moved up to that second group. Now, we've not seen Tony Stewart, the 20, hard to move off the bottom. Casey's starting to make a little ground up there in that second group.
Brian Vickers, the track record holder in the 25, battling Ricky Rudd.
There he goes. Got a lead change up here, boys.
Casey Kane's going to take the lead for the second time tonight. He started from the pole and led the first lap.
Started from the pole last night, probably had one of the best cars in the Busch race.
But the point leader, Jimmy Johnson's in the garage with Steve Burns.
And just out of the care center, Mike Joy, Jimmy, what happened on the racetrack? How badly damaged is the race car?
The car's pretty bad. Some cars in front of me sliding around and checked up, and I went to turn inside of them to miss them, and it just was a chain reaction deal. I got hit from behind and got in the inside wall, and then I was making my lap around just trying to get back to the pit road, and I went down the backstretch, and the steering failed, and when I climbed on the brakes with all the camera in the car and caster in it, when I got on the brakes, it turned right to the infield inside wall, and I hit the wall again, and if it didn't hurt the car bad enough the first time, I killed it the second time.
Do you have any idea if you can get back out there and run for points?
Possibly. We're going to try. We need to get every point that we can. So I know my guys will work hard to get those Monte Carlo back out on the track, and maybe some other guys will crash and we can pick up some spots.
Thank you, Jimmy.
Yep.
As things stand right now, Johnson, if he did not return to the race, would finish 40th, but he would keep the point lead by 45 points over Greg Biffle, who presently is the 7th place car. Busch is really giving Tony Stewart the workover for second place.
Larry, I think it's another one of those indications of these tires. Tony Stewart went under that caution. Looks like when they went back to green, his car isn't quite as good as it was before that caution came out, and the tires went through that heat cycle. Some cars it affects, some cars it doesn't seem to.
It was good after the restart, right after they put them on there, but like you say, after the restart, it's not been that strong.
It looks like the car likes sticker tires, and it doesn't want to stay out there on a set of cycle tires, heat cycle tires. Here goes Kurt.
As Jeff Green goes after Ricky Rudd, that's back at 22nd. Second place has changed hands. Kurt Busch, the new second place car. Harvick moving in.
And that's two of the cars that elected to come to pit road that last time and took 4 tires and more adjustments, as well as Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the 8 car, right up in front of them. Now we're starting to see a little movement by Kevin Harvick in the 29 car. Remember, in that first run, his car was seemed to be better on the long run.
Yeah, it seems like it takes his about 10, 15 laps to get going, and then he gets up on that outside and starts rocking and rolling. Matt.
Tony Stewart last pitted on 65. That's when they made a track car adjustment, trying to free the race car up, but it is still tight.
That's why he is slowly losing track position and fading back.
And Matt, I think that's going to be a key tonight. We talked about it in the beginning of the show. This racetrack, even though it was starting to get overcast, it was very, very warm. And I think the more this track cools down, the more rubber gets put on it. You're going to have to continue to make adjustments to keep up with the track conditions, even if your car is good.
Yeah, a tight race car, it means he's using the right front tire. You throw in a little brake heat, and then you throw in using that tire, abusing it. You get a lot of air pressure buildup. It's going to push even worse. And so they've got to do something pretty major to free that boy up.
So time for our singular virtual crew chief results. Tire changer has the toughest job in the pits. Sorry, Jeff. Hard to disagree with that one.
Jeff, when you see that it's on their shoulders to make sure those lug nuts are tight, I know it's on the shoulders of the jackman to let that car down when he knows they're done, but the tire changer has a pretty tough job.
No, he does, Larry, and I'll agree with you there. I've done it long enough to realize that the jackman may be the guy that starts and stops the start, but the tire changer himself, he can't have any mistakes. Otherwise, you're going to have a slow pit stop, and he's usually the guy that gets the blame for a lot of things.
Yeah, and not only Jeff, but the three men that are on the right side of that car in the carrier itself, but the guys on their knees with their feet sticking out in pit lane and guys going by them at 50 miles an hour, that takes a lot of nerve.
Like I've always said, real men work in the pits.
Or in the car.
Brian Newman hard at work. He's the fifth place car. And behind him, Jeff Burton. And as we talk about pit crew members out in the lane, we'll say hi to Burton's jackman, Josh Yost, who got injured and he's had surgery. He's under repair. He was at the pit crew championship Monday night in a wheelchair, and he's going to have a lengthy recovery, but he's going to be back.
And I know Daryl and I talked about the replacement jackman last night or yesterday, Curtis Bowman, who's filling in for Josh Yost. And I talked to Curtis today a little bit about that. He said, as we watched Greg Biffle in the 16, he said, Larry, it was a lug that was loose on the right front. He said, if it was on the left side, I probably would take more responsibility, but it was on the right front. So, you know, maybe we jumped the gun a little bit.
Yeah, and no, I wouldn't point a finger at the jackman by any means. It's a timing issue with any time there's a change on a crew, everybody's got to get familiar with that change, with that person. Tire changer, jackman, gasman, whatever. No way was we trying to blame anybody for a failure there. It was just an observation of maybe it threw somebody's timing off.
Rusty Wallace here behind Biffle is the eighth place car in Miller Lite Dodge. He's 7.5 seconds behind the race leader, being tracked by Dale Jarrett, who is a lap off the pace. And then Jeremy Mayfield in ninth, 8.4 seconds back.
See Elliott Sadler behind him, 38 car, qualified up in the fifth position. Made his way in the top 10, but I've been watching that car right there behind him, Jimmy McMurray in the 42 car. Didn't qualify that great back about mid-pack, but he's knocking on the door of the top 10.
He moves past Jason Leffler, a lap down to the FedEx car. Here is Kyle Busch, the rookie, in 12th place.
Of course, Kyle making his very first Nextel Cup start here, but he pretty much annihilated the field here last year in the Busch Series race.
Edwards coming into the picture, and that roundup for last night's winner in a dramatic last lap maneuver past Elliott Sadler that left Sadler displeased. And here's Dave Blaney, who just took 14th away from Jeff Gordon. But Gordon slides back a spot and perhaps into the clutches of Mark Martin, the 16th place car. These cars are about 12 seconds back of the leader. And a new paint scheme for Bobby Labonte. Kind of purplish and bluish, or maybe sky blue pink, I think I called it last night.
I told Larry, I said, it looked like me and the boys up in Owensboro got together late one night and decided we'd paint a race car.
Little of this, little of that.
What do you got?
The Boniva Chevrolet. Matt Kenseth in the number 17 Roush Ford, 13.5 seconds back of the lead. He's in 18th, and that's a pickup from where he was running prior to the last caution in 20th. Then you got to go back a little ways, about another second, to get to Dale Earnhardt Jr. and his DEI teammate Michael Waltrip. The Bud and the Napa cars run 19th and 20th right now. 15 seconds off the lead, Matt.
Junior trying to work his way through the field, but not having a lot of success. He says the car is loose on entry, but that's not a problem as much as the fact that the car is super tight in the center. In fact, he says it's like he's going over railroad tracks when he tries to make the car cut in the center of the corner. They back up on an air pressure adjustment and a chassis adjustment, still fighting the balance issue on the 8.
Ricky Rudd moves in to challenge for the top 20. He's had kind of an up and down night in the 21.
Yeah, he qualified in 6th, but Michael Fatback McSwain, his crew chief, decided on that last caution back on lap 82, coming to pit road for 4 tires. I know they were debating one of those shock adjustments all the way up to the point of putting the car through inspection this afternoon.
Well, he came here, had a great test, qualified well. I think they were expecting great things tonight. Maybe they'll get her dialed in before it's over with.
Right behind them, Jeff Green in the 43, Joe Nemechek the 01, and Kenny Schrader in the 49, who will be appearing tomorrow in Missouri at I-80 Speedway. Schrader, the hardest working man in show business.
He knew it was going to be an off day. He'd be racing somewhere.
114 laps complete. Ray Evernham's driver, Casey Kane, out front.
Time to check in on the Coca-Cola family of drivers fuel for refreshment. Kurt Busch, Harvick, Stewart, Jeff Burton, even Kyle Petty has led as well in this race. Elliott Sadler, Michael Walter, part of the DEI team there, currently running 20th with Dale Earnhardt Jr. 19th, and we have received word officially that points leader Jimmy Johnson is done for the night, but he won't lose his points hold coming out of this race.
Well, that's one of the benefits right now of having that lead and having that problem tonight like he did here today. It'll pay off as far as him being able to hang on to that lead.
And this last fall, this is the race where Jimmy lost the points lead. He had it coming in here and lost it, of course, before they went into the chase for the championship. Casey Kane currently the leader over Kurt Busch. But, Jeff, since we have the fireworks on the Friday night with Carl Edwards and Elliott Sadler, and they said it was over with, but currently Carl is 12th and Elliott right behind him running 13th.
Yeah, I think that just a lap or so ago, Carl was able to slide by Elliott. But, you know, Elliott pretty much told us, hey, I'm a big picture racing. I'm trying to win a championship. So that was last night. I'm focused on getting my car back to victory lane or up in the top 10 for sure tonight.
Worth keeping an eye on. Let's rejoin Darrell, Larry, and Mike.
The worst that could happen to Jimmy Johnson, who will finish this race in 40th position, is if Greg Biffle wins the race and leads the most laps, he would leave here in a tie with Biffle for the point lead going to Charlotte.
Now, I thought those two guys at 15 and 43 were told to stay away from each other.
And they did until now, Darrell, 125 laps into the race. These are the two cars that had a magnetic attraction for one another at Darlington and were both invited to spend some quality time with the NASCAR officials in the Oval Office after the race at Darlington.
It's a little smaller track. It's harder to stay.
Oh, around goes somebody over there.
Turn two, and it is Scott Riggs.
Caution is out.
Third caution of the night, and it comes at lap 126. Scott Wimmer will get the free pass as Scott Riggs.
I don't think he hit anything. He got a poke, I think.
And let me correct. I inadvertently moved I-80 Speedway to Missouri. Schrader will be in Nebraska tomorrow at Nebraska Raceway Park.
Gets down in here and hello.
We got a little help.
Is that Kyle that got?
That was definitely the 45 car, Kyle Petty.
Yeah.
From Kevin Harvick, as cars were fighting to.
In front, you get right front, back it down, right down. You're clear, go.
And you see the caution lights ablaze. So we'll have Craftsman pit stops at lap 127. Beginning with Steve.
Mike, on that run, Kurt Busch said his car started out way too loose. By the end of it, he was way too tight. When they get around to the left side tire, they're going to pull a spring rubber out of the left rear spring to help his car. Matt,
Tony Stewart lacking forward bite. Greg Zampinelli will make an air pressure adjustment to try to fix that. Also slight chassis adjustment. The car still tight. He just cannot get the gas when he needs to, Dick.
The adjustments made to Casey Kane's car in the last pit stop worked well. Kane pitted perfectly and is by far the first man off pit road with some adjustments in the back end of the car for tires and fuel. A nice pit stop by his guys.
Penalty. Dale Earnhardt Jr. too fast entering the pits.
But I'm going to tell you what really helps Casey Kane and that Tommy Bowen crew sitting on the butt pole, their pit selection, they're right at the end of pit road and they drop the jack. He just has to move a few feet to win that battle off pit road.
Third caution of the night at 128 laps in Richmond.
The Chevy American Revolution 400 brought to you by Budweiser, the official beer of NASCAR, proud sponsors of Dale Earnhardt Jr. and the number 8 car. Dale Earnhardt Jr. won this race last year, still looking for his first win of this season. Casey Kane leading Kurt Busch, Kevin Harvick and Tony Stewart, Jeff Burton rounding out the top five. Let's check out the biggest movers so far, Jeff.
And right now we take a look at Mark Martin. When he came into pits, he was 18th. He's now moved up, gained four positions, along with Travis Quapel also. So how about Dale Earnhardt Jr.? Big gain again.
Craftsman's biggest movers. Tony Stewart has led the most laps, followed by Casey Kane, who is your current leader. Let's rejoin Daryl, Larry, and Mike.
We'll restart with 31 cars on the lead lap. The last of which are Ricky Rudd and Dale Earnhardt Jr., who was penalized for too fast entering the pit with the electronic timing system. And Casey Kane leads Kurt Busch, Kevin Harvick, Tony Stewart, and Jeff Burton. Busch to the bottom for the lead.
Trying to get this lead in a hurry here on this restart. Just dove to the bottom of the racetrack off in the turn one.
Well, you got to take advantage of those new tires because you got the most grip for the next four or five laps.
Kurt Busch trying to get the five bonus points for leading a lap. He's got it. Tony Stewart trying to take advantage of Casey Kane for second. Puts the Home Depot Chevy up into second place. Kevin Harvick and Jeff Burton, meanwhile, have to deal with lap cars. And now they both clear the traffic, so the first five in order are the first five in the race. Steve.
And Mike, just to update you on Kevin Harvick on that pit stop. Harvick said he's been just a little bit tight all night. They made a small air pressure adjustment. He is tight from the center of the corner off.
Thanks, Steve. Kyle Petty got pushed out of line in turn two. Again, got that stuff on the tires. Lead change, Stewart. Right back to the front. On the bottom, Kurt Busch arcs it in, but he's going to give the spot up to Stewart.
I think Stewart's car is bad fast on sticker tires. I mean, he can get to the lead in a hurry on sticker tires.
If you watched us last night on FX, Stewart's car looked a lot like Clint Boyer's did, the two car for much of that race. Rocket fast on new tires, but had to be out front. Couldn't climb the ladder late in the race.
And I think the history on that 9 car, if you think about it through the last year and a half, has been the fact that they don't run very good on new tires. They run better on older tires, like they would start real low on air pressure. You can get way down on air. Hey, these two guys are hanging together again tonight. I like
together again.
Still.
Wonder what they're thinking.
That's the 43 of Jeff Green and the 15 of Michael Waltrip, both Owensboro, Kentucky natives, and they spent a lot of time together last week at Darlington.
We're seeing a tire rub on Kyle Petty, the 45 car. I would say when he got bottlenecked up over there in turn two, we were talking about someone probably got into him and pushed the fender in on the left front tire. Probably going to have to come to pit road and fix that. I know what his hopes are right now is he's sitting there, I think, basically one lap down that a caution comes out and he can fix it under caution.
Show you how tough it is to pass here. They restarted, what, five laps ago, and already Dale Earnhardt Jr. is half a lap down to race leader Tony Stewart after serving that penalty, Matt.
Junior has now pitted three times, Mike. The car still tight. Pete Rondeau made an air pressure adjustment to try to free up the race car in the center of the corner, but then Pete told Junior something that shocked him.
Hi, June. We got caught too fast entering.
What?
off at too fast entering pit road.
With everybody else.
I'm sorry, Judge. I was just going as fast as everybody else.
And he dropped from 19th all the way back to 30th. And Mike, we saw last night in the Busch race, track position so important. We saw the two-car from Boyer pit late, couldn't make his way back up through there. A lot of traffic through Junior's windshield.
Yeah, but I think the difference is Clint Boyer had a good handling car. It's when you have a bad handling car and they stick you at the back of the field, that's when you're in trouble.
You're going to be in trouble because you know what's going to happen to you? You're going to be seeing that leader before too long, and he's going to be behind you.
Or when you stop again, you're going to take chances. No tires, two tires, do something different to get out of sequence and get track position back.
Oh boy, next Saturday night, under the lights at Lowe's, All-Star Race.
A million smackers.
No points, no cares, just that million bucks.
There you see our top three in our Fox track. You can see the miles per hour down to about 95 miles per hour in the middle of the corner. In these straightaways, over 150 miles per hour.
Steve's in his pit.
Hey, Mike, before the race restarted, Kurt Busch asked Jimmy Fenwick to have the crew check for blisters on the set of tires they took off. He said on three occasions during that run, he saw puffs of smoke inside the car. Jimmy Fenwick reported back that the tires looked okay. Kurt said, I'm not sure what it was, but again, the report is the tires looked all right.
Well, it could be as rubber builds up on the racetrack, you get a piece of rubber up inside the engine compartment, it'll fall down on the header, and it'll sit there and kind of puff and burn itself out. And these tires are shredding rubber off of them pretty badly, and so I think that's probably what happened. He got a piece of rubber up on the header, smelled it burning, probably gone now.
Coming up on 150 of 400 laps, Tony Stewart, former IRL and NASCAR champion, is out in front. It's hard to follow here at Richmond when everybody wants to lead, and the man who came in here leading the points, Jimmy Johnson, is out of the race and finishes 40th. Tony Stewart has led 107 of the 156 laps so far in that number 20, but his persistent shadow has been Kurt Busch. Pole sitter Casey Kane third, Kevin Harvick, Jeff Burton.
This car here, though, we've been watching him. I've been watching him during breaks, especially Jamie McMurray in the 42 car, qualified back in the 17th position. Remember, even though he missed the chase when we were here in September, he had a good race car that night. Now he's moved up to the top 10, up in the 8th position. This car looks pretty good on this long run.
He's about a second behind Greg Biffle and 2 seconds ahead of Jeremy Mayfield, so right there in the rocking chair. Jeff Gordon slipped back a bit. He's back in 16th, just ahead of Carl Edwards and Jeff Green. Or make that now, Jeff Green in the 43 and Carl Edwards. Or not.
Pretty impressed with Jeff Green. We talked about him a little while ago, and he told us, and I heard him on the NASCAR Live earlier today on Speed Channel. He said, you know what, there's no question running that Busch car, the 4 car for the Biagi brothers is going to help my Cup car.
For the lead. Busch is just harassing Tony to pieces here.
Tony's car just seems to fall off after, 20, 25 laps. He seems to lose a little speed, and a number of these guys, Kurt Busch, Casey Kane, and Kevin Harvick, they seem to catch him back up.
A lot like last night's race, when Tony's number 20 was the 2 of Clint Boyer, and Busch's 97 was the 90 of Elliott Sadler. Sadler was reeling Boyer on the long runs, and that's what Busch has done to Stewart. But it's not just Busch. It's Casey Kane also. Chevy Ford Dodge here fighting for the lead.
In about another probably 8 to 10 laps, they're going to catch the tail end of the field. And guess who the tail end of that field is going to be? Will be Dale Earnhardt Jr. in that 8 Budweiser car.
Yeah, you know what? It's almost like that penalty just took all the life out of the 8 car. We saw last week at Darlington when he, look out here, boys.
It looked like last week, you know, when they made a mistake and didn't come in and get tires one time, it kind of sucked the life out of him, and it's done it again tonight.
There he goes, though. Kurt Busch, that 97 car, he takes the lead away from Tony Stewart. Look at Casey Kane in the 9, turns it to the bottom. He won second place.
Not going to get it this time, and the almost wreck we had was in turn 4 where Kyle Petty and Scott Wimmer got together but managed to straighten it out.
Boy, Casey just was able to pick that throttle up off turn 4. He just drove by Tony Stewart before they got to the start-finish line.
Larry, I believe what happens at 20 cars, he uses that right front tire up. You know, it builds up a lot of pressure, and if they get to where it won't turn, and he can't get back to the throttle, and that's why they're able to drive by him.
Well, we heard Matt Yoakum say the car is tight. It's pushing the front end slide.
Right back there behind those guys, don't forget, though, is that 31 car. I mean, he is coming to the front in a hurry, too, with Jeff Burton.
Which brings us to our next singular virtual crew chief question. Rusty Wallace is the winningest active driver at this track. Jeff Gordon's had a lot of success, and Rusty goes around.
And I'm going to tell you, Michael Walters, how he avoided him. Looked like Jeff Gordon maybe in the 24, but got up in the wall.
No, he didn't hit the wall. He just almost did.
It has been a night of a lot of almosts.
Almost, yeah.
Because Rusty was running in about the 12th position, and here come about position 13th through 25th at him.
But you know one thing, they talk about Tony Stewart and what happens to his car. These short runs are perfect for him. By the time he starts to give up, they get a caution, he gets tires.
We just had talked about it, and that caution, a huge break for Dale Earnhardt Jr., who was just about to go a lap down in the 8 car.
So who's our short track king? Text the word crew to 191 on your singular wireless phone or go to foxsports.com to vote.
Look at that nose on that Dodge. Isn't that a funny looking thing, the way it's on the short tracks, the way it's made?
Can't think of what kind of fish that looks like. But
yeah.
It's kind of like a muskie or a walleye or you know, one of those. But anyway.
I bet the 18 and the 2 get together because they've been racing hard. And around goes Wallace.
Well, what this did do, it pretty much brought about 30 of our 31 lead lap cars to pit road. Kyle Petty in the 45, he stayed out again trying to get those 5 points, Steve.
Larry, Matt, Kurt Busch said his car changed dramatically in 32 laps. They dropped the track bar mid-air pressure adjustment. Matt.
And the 20 car, Tony Stewart, down and away. Great stop by the Home Depot team. They made a track bar adjustment again, Dicker, still trying to work on the exit of the corner.
Casey Kane's team has been flawless, and once again, they are the first ones out of pit road. Congratulating each other. These guys have been hot tonight. They have not lost a single spot on pit road, and on most of these stops, they have made chassis adjustments. They are doing every bit as well as their driver, Casey Kane. Team effort.
Bobby Labonte got blocked in trying to leave his pit. Couldn't get past Carl Edwards. And here's another look at what happened between Labonte and Wallace. Boy, we saw a lot of incidents just like this last night.
Just watch how close Michael Walter up in the 15 car just all but slides by.
Spin it, grab a gear, and go. Just your typical short track Saturday night. ...169 laps complete as our Chevy pace car cam looks back at Casey Kane, who's about to get back on the throttle ahead of Tony Stewart, Ryan Newman, Kevin Harvick, and Kurt Busch. Jeff Gordon spent an extra lap in the pits making repairs and adjustments to the tie rod.
He's got something wrong, Mike. He didn't come up to speed, and he just got a problem. What is it, man?
DW, he lost a lap. He knocked the toe out. Contact with the wall when the two cars spun. Problems continue for the 24.
We saw him stringing the car like they were checking the toe. We wondered if he hit the wall. He's definitely got a problem.
Tony has no problem. He's doing just what he did on the last restart, running one lap, diving to the bottom, and retaking the lead.
But we just want to mark that because, you know, if we get late cautions here, that's going to be good for the 20 car.
We need to make note that Kurt Busch, the 97 car, those guys had a problem on the right front with a lug nuts reason. He fell back. Look at Ryan Newman, Kevin Harvick in the 29 there, battling for third position.
Boy, Harvick was really kind to Newman there because he could have forced it down in there, but he gave him a break.
Now, Jeff Burton is running in eighth, but he had a mishap exiting his pit. Burton pulls out. Jamie McMurray is there. Watch the bump there. And now look at the, you'll see the damage on Burton's car on the right front.
And what would really concern me is that's where the right front brake duct area is. We've been talking a lot about cooling these brakes. It looks like possibly all of that brake duct may be torqued, which could be a problem, Dick Burton.
But no surprise, the spotter, Rocky Ryan, has told Burton, don't worry about a thing. That right front corner looks just fine. They're trying to pump him up. It's been such a long time since Jeff Burton has won a race anywhere. Phoenix, 122 starts ago, October 2001. He hasn't won since then. He had a good car before that pit stop. He was running in fifth spot.
I think he's still got a good car, Dick, as he runs in eighth place. Let's go back about, 12th place on back. Elliott Sadler on back, where you see the six of Mark Martin working around the 92 of Tony Raines. That's a lap car. And behind him, here comes Jeff Green in the 43, Ricky Rudd, Rusty Wallace, Dave Blaney, and Matt Kenseth, all in one big Y.
As these cars adjust, every time there's a caution, they adjust, they all get more equal, and they all start running closer together in tight packs.
Three wide.
Not for long.
Jeff Green slipped up the hill, and it's Blaney who bursts out of that pack in the 07. He and Ricky Rudd now fight for 14th as we go up to third place, where Kevin Harvick's trying to take it from Ryan Newman. Not this time, Ryan says.
But I'll tell you, I'm so impressed with this 12 car. I know we still have a long way to go, 223 laps, but Jeff Hammond talked about it in the pre-race. This is a backup car this 12 had to unload, and they really didn't get any long runs with this car. They just barely got out at the end of that practice session, went out and sat on the outside pole.
Well, you know, Larry, they gave one away last week. Not pitting might have been the right choice, and maybe it would have been if a whole bunch of those lead lap cars had not pitted with him.
Just think about this. If they wad up on the restart, he wins the race. And so that was what he was thinking, I believe. They get a caution on that restart, he wins the race.
I mean, this racetrack is plenty wide enough for three cars, but the groove really isn't. As you see Tony Raines in the 92 car, he didn't know what to do. He was just trying to get out of the way.
But the man in the right spot was Dave Blaney. It seems if you're on the bottom, everything that happens on this racetrack is going to shove up to the outside. And Blaney did a good job of taking advantage there. Matt's in Ryan Newman's pit.
He's got his mirror full of GM Goodrich. Now Newman, he felt like they were not making a big enough adjustment. So the last stop, they made a wedge and track bar adjustment. The car still way too tight for Ryan's liking this early on in the race.
Harvick dogging Newman in fourth. Kurt Busch back to fifth. And Jamie McMurray, sixth and trying to close. Jeff Gordon has come back to pit road. Jimmy Johnson hit
right side on there when he picked up.
Johnson hit the wall and broke a tie rod, his Hendrick teammate, and they came in here 1-2 in points. They have had to adjust a tie rod, and now they're pulling the right front off again.
And it looks like not only are they going to change right side tires, they're going to continue to adjust on that some more. And the thing about it, we thought that Jeff Gordon went up and maybe hit the wall when Rusty Wallace spun out. Looks like maybe a tie rod issue. I know Jimmy Johnson had a pretty severe lick, but a tie rod broke on that car as well. Tell you what, we're riding with Michael Waltrip in the 15 car, qualified back in the 23rd position. Maybe it was not that good at the beginning of the race, but here he's moving into the top 10. If he can complete the pass on Elliott Sadler in the 38, Michael told us, Darrell, this is the same car he ran second at Phoenix. If I can get that second groove like I did at Phoenix, I'm going to be good.
Yeah, he did, but I tell you, we were talking talking about the 38, and he just actually passed Michael. So I was watching those two guys, and all of a sudden the 38 gets around Michael, and looks like his car's really tuned in now.
And that's exactly what they did to his Busch car last night. Not very good in the beginning, ended up finishing second.
Tony Stewart has Kasey Kahne beginning to close. The gap is down to 0.4 seconds after 187 laps. We're almost to halfway in the Chevy American Revolution 400.
Time for a Visa race break from Richmond, Virginia. Jimmy Johnson, who came in as the points leader for the last seven races, with some problems here, Jeff.
Yeah, he gets turned around by the 77 car of Travis Pauple. He gets in the inside wall. It looks like everything's pretty good, but all of a sudden, something breaks on the front end. It turns the car dead in the inside wall once again. Ended his night real early.
Done for the night. He lost the championship lead here last fall with a 36th place finish. Here, Kurt Busch passing Kasey Kahne. Tony Stewart passing Kurt Busch for the lead. It's been traded back and forth. And then moments ago, Rusty Wallace having some problems. He's not racing Tony Danza here.
No, Bobby Labonte gets into his left rear corner, spins him around, but just a second ago, here comes Kasey Kahne once again, passing the 20 car of Tony Stewart for the lead.
Jeff Gordon headed to the garage, Hendrick Motorsports, as you saw with Jimmy Johnson, too. Some problems here for Jeff Gordon. Another impound race having problems.
Yeah, he got in the outside wall and had to take it behind the wall to get his car worked on.
So this is how it looked coming in, the way the points stand, and then you see running currently and how that would affect the points up to the moment, as it will change to show you exactly where Jeff Gordon would fall to, how Greg Biffle and Kurt Busch would move up. This has been a Visa race break.
Now, seeing Jeff Gordon drive that car, not just behind the wall, but all the way to the garage, I think kind of indicates his frustration with what's befallen him. The last time that both Gordon and Jimmy Johnson failed to finish in the same race was almost a year ago. It was Dover last June, but the number one and two point men are now in the garage, Matt.
The car up on jack stands, Mike. Gordon came on the radio and said, whatever is broken, you guys still have not found it because the car is horrible. Robbie Lewis told them to take it back to the garage. They didn't want to take a chance of having whatever is wrong with this car cause an even bigger issue.
But their little teammate, Kyle Busch, is not having a pretty nice run here. He's back in ninth place, and his car looks pretty good. It's clean, and, you know, he had a great run going to Darlington last week and had a right front tire failure. Otherwise, he'd have had a nice finish there.
And the other Hendrick car, the track record holder, Brian Vickers, is 26th. He's also still on the lead lap.
But even though the 48 and 24 has had problems, this is about the same scenario that we saw at Phoenix 3 weeks ago. Kyle Busch ran in the top 10 all night long, as well as Brian Vickers. Jimmy Johnson and Jeff Gordon, they were not very good. No top 10 finishes.
So not since that race, Larry, have we seen this kind of flip-flop among the four Hendrick cars. Between them, Rick Hendrick's teams and Jack Roush's five teams have won 14 of the last 16 Cup races. There's one streak better than that. It goes all the way back to 1971. We'll fill you in a minute as Kurt Busch, the leading Roush car, tries once again to move on Ryan Newman for third place.
And Ryan Newman in the 12, he's running that higher groove, and he gets that good lunge off the corner by being up the racetrack just a little bit.
Yeah, with that higher gear, you know, that they have to pull now, that does get it off a corner if you can keep it up high and keep it freed up.
See right here, Kurt Busch in the 97 beats him down to the middle of the corner, but when they put their foot back in the throttle, Ryan Newman to the high side, he wins the battle off the corner.
It's just so hard to run off the corner under somebody. You need the whole racetrack right there to be able to get up the hill, and you got to get out of the throttle and can't make the pass.
Kurt Busch can ever get side by side with him, I think, on the exit of the corner. He may can win the battle to the next set of corners.
Yeah, because he can definitely get in a little bit better. But while they're doing all that, there comes Harvick right up there behind him, too.
So let's get your answer to our singular virtual crew chief question. Who's the short track king? Rusty Wallace, six wins here at Richmond.
and has led over 3,000 laps. He's led a total of like 7.5 complete races at this racetrack.
Wallace, however, has not yet led tonight. He is in 22nd place. Let's check with Steve.
And Jeff Gordon out of the race car, Mike. And Jeff, I saw you walk over the right front part of the race car. What are they looking at? Can you get back in the race?
I apologize to this team. That's the dumbest thing I think I've ever done in my life. I saw a car spin way up ahead of me, and spotter said go high, and I just started slowing down, trying to stay up next to the wall, and I just ran right into it. I didn't even think I was going fast enough to hit it, but I hit it a lot harder than I thought. And we can fix it, but it's going to take a while to fix it. By the time we do that, won't be many laps left. It's not worth going back out there.
Jeff, do you know exactly what's broken on the right front?
It's just, upper control on suspension stuff, tie rods and drag links and all that normal suspension stuff that happens when you hit the wall. Thank you.
Gordon is already 23 laps down, and the length of the repair would take quite some time.
And he's right. I mean, I was looking sort of at it. If he hit the wall, he didn't hit it very hard. It didn't even knock the letters off the tires, and it did no body damage to the car. So he must have just taken a direct hit in the right front. Boy, I'll tell you one thing. There's guys right now that are giving our leader a fit, trying to stay on the lead lap.
Brian Vickers, the 25. Scott Wimmer, the 22.
Yeah, now that we're 40 laps since that last restart, we're starting to catch a lot of lap traffic, our leader, and he's boxed in behind Wimmer and Vickers right now.
Dick Bergman's in the leader's pit.
He's got a really, really good car, Mike, and it's an interesting set of circumstances that seem to be happening to Casey Kane. He'll get terrific pit stops, he'll come out of a round of pit stops with the lead, and then one after another, a couple cars will pass him. What's going on is he's being very conservative with the brakes, asking his crew even to tell him how tightly the rotors are glowing, and they can do that because their pit is right here in turn one, where the rotors glow most brightly. So he's being conservative on that end of things, but he's got some help from his tires. Takes him about 20 laps to come in, and when they come in, oh boy, he has got one terrific race car.
Yeah, well, he's got one terrific problem right now. Actually, it's two. It's the 22 and the 25. They're holding him up so badly. Here comes Tony and Kurt Busch that are catching him at about a second a lap right now.
And somebody's going to find their way through. Casey Kane is one of the prime subjects on NASCAR Drivers 360, which begins a new season tonight on FX after the race.
And after the Busch race last night, Linda and I watched the new version of the Casey Kane and Rusty Wallace. It's awesome. It's a show you have to watch.
Casey Kane trying to win his first NASCAR Nextel Cup race. He leads Tony Stewart, Kurt Busch, and Ryan Newman.
All right, thanks, Steve. If you'd like to be considered and appear as the Nextel Fan of the Week, go to www.foxsports.com/Nextel and enter today. You could be next. Casey Kane trying to put Everham Motorsports in victory lane for the first time since last fall when Mayfield won in Richmond. Kurt Busch, Tony Stewart working it right here. And for the lead, Jeff.
I'm telling you right now, they have been swapping the lead back and forth. If you look back at what was going on a minute ago, because Casey Kane was the leader. Guys ran up on the back of Sterling Marlin. Casey Kane down low, Tony Stewart up high. Tony kept the pressure on upstairs. The next thing you know, the door opened up, and he was able to get just out in front of Casey Kane. Cuts low, gets by Kane for that position, but brings Kurt Busch right along with him up on the high side. Casey could not get by or hang on to that lead right there. He'd get kicked all the way back to third, but all of a sudden, here comes Kurt Busch. He gets up underneath Tony Stewart.
And Kurt Busch takes the lead.
Takes the lead away from him.
Tony Stewart.
Great racing so far.
Trying to win his fourth Richmond race. Tony Stewart has led the most laps, but Kurt Busch, Mike, your leader right now.
Maybe not for long. Tony's tried him high side, low side, and they're coming up on Mike Bliss, Scott Wimmer, and Dale Earnhardt Jr. So going to be a lot of lap traffic and plenty of choices for the three leaders of which way to go here.
Well, definitely lap traffic is playing a huge factor, but Darrell, I definitely think they have that 20 car where it's a little better on the longer run now than they did earlier in the race.
Yeah, it is a little bit, Larry, but that 9 car was way, way out there. He got boxed in twice, and that's what's cost him the lead. He's being really, really cautious with that race car. I'll give him credit for that, Casey Kane in the 9.
when Kane was stuck on the bottom underneath Kurt Busch's car, looked very loose going into the corner, and he wasn't able to keep pace on the bottom. But now it's Mike Bliss, who's been trying to stay on the lead lap. Stewart edges ahead. Quaker State aerial coverage showing Tony Stewart putting Mike Bliss a lap down, and now Stewart goes after the side-by-side battle on the left of your screen, Scott Wimmer and Dale Earnhardt Jr. Darrell, it can't be much fun to be the leader in this kind of situation, with cars in front of you running double wide, trying to stay on the lead lap.
Well, that's the whole thing. And again, this is that kind of racetrack where you can run high and low. And because of that, you get two guys side by side, they can hold you up and it costs you a second a lap. That's what happened to Casey Kane. Now he's got to get back around these guys and get the lead back.
Seventh place, Jeff Burton, that nose damaged in a pit road scuffle with Jamie McMurray. He gets past Greg Biffle, moves up to seventh.
Greg Biffle's not ready to just roll over, but as much as we thought is that damage on that right front fender was going to hurt that 31 car, so far it's not hurt him, it don't appear.
And Larry and Mike, you know, I'm noticing off, I don't know what direction that is over there, I guess that'd be the east. There's some lightning that's flashing over behind the grandstand over there. Some of those spotters may be telling these guys, hey boys, better pick it up. Because we see a lot of guys kind of pushing the issue right now.
I don't know who's pushing the issue, trying to push the issue down.
Whoa, Stewart around! He gets away and there is no other contact. But Tony Stewart, the leader, was trying to work the double wide lap, almost lap traffic of Scott Wimmer and Dale Earnhardt Jr. And Stewart goes around.
Yeah, I'm surprised this has not happened before now, because these guys have been all over the place trying to get by these lap cars, and the lap cars running side by side doesn't give them a lot of options.
Somehow, someway, Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the Budweiser, the 8 car, stayed on the lead lap. What a break for him.
Despite the spin, you've got to admire Stewart's car control in ending that spin facing the right way.
He just gassed her up a little too early, and around the back end came. That can happen to you real easily in that turn, especially with a tight car. How about it, Steve?
Yeah, Kurt Busch is a little tight, DW. They're going to do a half turn on the track bar. Kurt Busch said, let's not do too much to it. A little tight on 97. Matt.
Zippy asked Tony Stewart what he needed. He said, after a few chuckles, said, I need some more forward fight. Mark Robertson said, well, we needed to come for tires anyway. When they were talking about the spin, going to make an air pressure adjustment, Dick, and see if they can fix the 20.
Well, second place, he was running on the racetrack. The wrench back into the rear end of the car again. They made their adjustment. Their four tire change is done. And guess what? Casey Kane beats them all out again.
You gotta love Tony Stewart. Anybody who can spin out of the lead and laugh about it, my kind of racer.
Yeah, well, you can when you don't hit anything.
Right.
As funny as all get out. And then there's nobody to be mad at because you're all by yourself. So you just laugh it off and get back after it.
No question. He needs a little more forward bite, though.
Caution of the night. It's for race leader Tony Stewart. Casey Kane first out of the pits. Matt Kenseth is our new leader. Leads Kurt Busch and Tony Stewart here with 162 laps to go. Good time for a Visa race break here in Richmond with Jeff Hammond, Chris Myers from the Hollywood Hotel. We've already had 19 lead changes. The record for lead changes in this race, 25. So some pretty good racing so far and some headliners doing it.
We've seen some great racing so far and great, I think, passes for the lead of second place, third place. I mean, this is what short track racing is all about. And this is the one thing we've seen at Richmond so many, many, many times in the past. And it's good to see it back.
So far, tempers have been cool, but you can bet the guys at Hendrick Motorsports a little hot bothered about the way they've run, including points leader Jimmy Johnson. Seven straight races leading in points, but out of things early here.
take a look right there. He has problems, spins out, also breaks the front end part, turned him dead in the inside wall once again, ended his night early. We see his teammate right there, Jeff Gordon, got in the wall also, had to go behind the wall, make repairs, but we understand he is now back out on the racetrack, and hopefully those repairs will allow him to continue and gain some championship points.
Came in second in points, and coming into the race, you can see as we keep an eye on where guys are running and how it affects their race for the points. Remember, we're almost at the halfway point of the 26th race mark of the season and the chase for the championship. So currently running, you see the points, that's where they would be now. So Jeff Gordon would lose a little ground. Biffle and Kurt Busch would move up a little. Ryan Newman also in position as well. And speaking of Greg Biffle, like Jeff Gordon, going for his fourth win of this year, Greg running consistently seventh here in the top 10.
I think he's big picture racing. We take a look right there at Greg Zipidelli, crew chief for Tony Stewart. When you talk about Greg Biffle, I got a chance to talk to his crew chief, Doug Richard, earlier today. He said, my driver is so much more mature than a year ago. They're up basically 21 positions from where they were a year ago at the same time. So these guys have really matured and come together as a team.
And Tony Stewart, who brought out the last caution, has led the most laps after that super save. But Casey Kane leading Kurt Busch and Tony running third. This has been a Visa race break. Mike?
Getting set to restart. 240 laps complete. Dodge Ford Chevy. As you have a look from the 390 horsepower Chevy SSR pace car. Kurt Busch comes to pit road as they get one to go. Steve?
Mike, I was just listening to Jimmy Fennec. They think they have a lug nut jam. You can see their work on the right front. They're pointing down to that area. Jimmy Fennec isn't saying anything on the radio, but you can see.
Right side on, just put right side on.
Now you're listening to the radio communication. Work continues in the area underneath that right front wheel well.
About halfway down the back.
Bad, bad break for Kurt Busch. Jimmy Fennec continues to watch. Long time here on pit road.
Another of the point leaders in trouble. Jimmy Johnson crashes. Jeff Gordon spends time at the garage. And Kurt Busch, a long pit stop. And here comes the field for the green flag. Busch is going to go a lap down as Casey Kane brings us back to green.
Looked like, Larry, they had a hammer and a screwdriver there trying to get a spacer plate off.
Well, yeah, it said a lug nut was hung. I don't know if that would have been one of the lug nuts that came off, got up in there and got hung into something, but obviously he's going to go a lap down here.
Steve?
Mike, what I can add to that right now is Kurt Busch told Jimmy Fennec that he heard a terrible grinding noise. We'll follow up as soon as we can to find out what caused it.
Now, I have seen a lug nut get hung between the wheel and the rotor itself, and that could be what happened there.
And it's like that's what they were trying to do, is hammer it out of there, chisel it out of there.
Yeah, that must be what it was.
Casey Kane, Tony Stewart, Ryan Newman, Jamie McMurray, and Kyle Busch in fifth place. Three wide out of turn two once again. Wow, and it's Kyle Busch on the bottom against a couple of lap cars.
Oh, by the way, they didn't mean to do that. Kenny Schrader just got him in that position because he got up the hill too far.
But Kyle Busch in the five car, he's up to the top five in a fifth position.
Jason Lefter in the 11's got a decent car, but he got a lap down early, so that's why he's battling there, not for position, but to try to be the first car one lap down. On this last caution, Mike Bliss got the free pass back up onto the lead lap.
I believe they just keep making Greg Biffle the 16 cars a little better, a little better. You know, these guys will probably at least have at least one more pit stop as we have about 150 laps to go. You see Kevin Harvick right behind him in the 29 car. They lost about six positions on that pit stop, Steve.
Yeah, Larry Mack, and Kevin Harvick is not happy about it. He said, guys, we at least have to maintain. We can't keep losing spots to the pits. Remember, he was fifth last week late in the race at Darlington. They had a problem with an impact wrench, dropped him way back in the field. Todd Ferrier, the crew chief, described their pit work tonight as sloppy. Kevin also said to crew chief, or to car owner Richard Childress, this has got to end sometime, Richard.
Especially the later in the race. And I'm going to tell you, we're riding with Jeff Burton right now. Last time off turn two, that like to have been a big
wreck over there with this group right here.
Yeah, actually what happened is the four car checked up in front of Michael a little bit. Michael gave him a little shot. When he did, it blocked the whole racetrack.
Looked like one of these parking lots trying to empty after the race. Newman McMurray, this is for third place. Jamie got under Ryan going into turn one. Couldn't quite hold the bottom, and here we go again. Mike Wallace, the meat in the sandwich, as Burton goes by on the outside, and Brian Vickers. Now, he's battling Mike Wallace, I think, for position one lap down.
I'll tell you one thing, that top groove off of turn two now is getting better and better. I see more and more cars really making good moves off of that corner.
So, Jeff, what happened to Kurt Busch to put him a lap down?
Mike, when they came in on the pit stop, when you start taking your lug nuts off, they fly all over the place. And what happened, one of them landed right here between the caliper and the rotor. As he drove off, it wedged itself in that area and embedded itself probably up into the caliper itself. As it was going around the racetrack, Kurt could feel it grinding on the rotor. And what would happen if it left it in there very long, it would eat this rotor all the way apart and it would eventually fail, and that would be bad news. So they had to come in and knock it out as this here got fell out, but they knocked it out of there. Now he can go back and try to compete, make up that lap. And I don't think he's damaged anything. He should be okay the rest of the evening.
Yeah, well, one thing you don't want to have here, Jeff, you well know, is brake problems, because you can't run around here with a brake failure. It's a brake problem. Well,
he's got a long road to go, though, with 140 laps to go. He's not even close right now to being the first car a lap down. He's back in the 34th position.
Kurt Busch came in here fourth in points. He would slip to eighth based on where he is right now. So three of our top four drivers coming in here in the points have had trouble. The one who has not is Greg Biffle, who is the sixth place car.
The worst thing you do to Kurt Busch is put him in an emotional situation like that. He needs to maintain his cool and work his way back up through there patiently.
Welcome back to Richmond. Nice to have you here with us on FX. You can enter the weekly Gillette Young Guns Challenge. One lucky fan who correctly picks the top placing Gillette Young Gun each week will win $5,000 as you check them out, how they're currently running. Log on to GilletteYoungGuns.com for details. Enter for a chance to win. The Gillette Young Gun Challenge is brought to you by M3 Power, the world's best shave. Currently with 137 laps to go, Casey Kane in his Dodge, Tony Stewart in a Chevy. And then you see Ryan Newman, who's on the front row, and Jamie McMurray, and Ryan Newman in that backup car, Jeff, hanging in there.
Doing a great job. And Chris, one other thing I want to point out, we've got five Dodges in the top 10 right now. So real strong showing tonight on this short track at Richmond by the Dodge Charger.
Again, Tony Stewart has led the most laps, 138. Casey Kane right behind him, 109. As we're going to look at Elliott Sadler, working himself in position for the 10th spot. Michael Waltrip just in front of him at 9. And Greg Biffle hanging in there as well in that 7th spot.
Yeah, he seems like he's pretty comfortable right there riding around. Kurt Busch, Kyle Busch right now is also up there in 5th place. And he's having a real strong run for that rookie. He's pacing himself really well and representing Hendrick Motorsports, since he's basically him and Brian Vickers the only two left.
And once again, points leader Jimmy Johnson out of the race on lap 81 with problems. Jeff Ford is back in, but running well behind. Mike?
Elliott Sadler wants this race probably more than anybody here. And right behind him, Dave Blaney in the 07 making the pass on Michael Waltrip. But Sadler had a race taken from him last night on the very last lap. Carl Edwards got up against Elliott's rear bumper, squirreled him up in turn two, and Edwards led only the last lap of the Funai 250 and won it. Sadler said, "I wouldn't have raced you that way." Elliott really wants to win on his home track.
That's what Elliott said. He said, "It's not so much about what happened. It's just how I had my sights set on my win here at my home track." And he said, "You know, I had a tire going down left front. I knew when I slid up the hill a little bit, opened the door, and gave Carl the opportunity, and he took advantage of it."
Sadler's whole family for many, many years has come here to the fairgrounds at Richmond and now the International Speedway to watch. I believe I read this morning that his cousins still have seats here on the front straightaway. Come to watch he and older brother Hermie run.
And this has not been one of his best racetracks. 12 starts, best finish of 12. I'll tell you who's made a nice recovery, though. Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the 8 car. He has moved up into the top 20 now to the 19th position. He was within just about a car length of going a lap down twice. Also had that pit road entering speeding penalty a little earlier in the race.
race, so this group's about to recover from that.
That penalty set him back, and he's now just now starting to overcome that. And the car looks a whole lot better than it did early on.
You know, Jeff Hammond made note that we have five Dodges in about the top eight right now. The one thing that I'm looking here, remember 10 races this year, Hendrick and Roush, they have won 9 of those races. We only have 2 Hendrick Roush cars in the top 15 right now.
And only one Hendrick car in the top 15, that is Kyle Busch. I said earlier that the Hendrick and Roush teams between them have won 14 of the last 16 races. The record, 1971. 15 out of 17 races were won by either Petty Enterprises or the Holman and Moody Ford teams. And the difference between that and this, it was only 2 drivers.
That's about it, dude. A little bit more fighting up off might work. 10-4.
Richard Petty and Bobby Allison, between them, won 15 of 17 races in 1971.
I'm rounding these numbers off, but between Hendrick and Roush, they have won 30 of the last 50 races. Wow.
We're watching Kyle Busch here in the 5 car in the 5th position right now. We have a couple of the Hendrick cars. There you see Jeff Gordon back on pit road. Now he's 54 laps down. Jimmy Johnson, the 48 car, is on the truck, and Brian Vickers right now in the 25 car, he's a lap down in 33rd. So right now, Kyle Busch is the only hope for Hendricks tonight.
Hick.
Kyle Busch is running really, really well tonight, Larry. He started in the 10th position. Right now, he's running in the 5th spot. A lot of conversation between this young 20-year-old driver and Alan Gustafson, his 29-year-old coachee. The car is nearly perfect. It's a little loose here and a little bit tight there. Gustafson has made good adjustments on the car to keep his driver running up front. Pit crew has also done their job, picked up 3 spots on that last round of pit stops. And let's remember who won the Busch race here last year in May. Kyle Busch dominated and won it.
He did do that. And right now, Casey Kane in the 9 car, our leader, about 35 laps after restart, he's starting to catch the tail end of the field again. A lot of heavy, heavy traffic in front of him.
And there's Dale Earnhardt Jr., Carl Edwards, and a bunch of cars not too far ahead of him. They better pick it up or they're going to go a lap down again or getting close to it.
18th place race on the right of your screen, Nemechek and Kenseth. Casey Kane has had 6 runner-up finishes. He is still looking for win number 1 in Nextel Cup. James Hilton had 12 second place finishes before his first win came in 1970.
This short track program for Casey Kane really come to life this year versus last year, his rookie season. Remember, about a month and a half ago, Martinsville had a good run, finished 2nd. So the short track program really coming around for Tommy Baldwin in this group.
Joe Nemechek holds off Matt Kenseth and passes Travis Quaffle. So here comes Kenseth trying to move up into the 18th position.
But like Darrell pointed out, these guys are desperate right now because the leader's only about 2 seconds behind them.
Yeah, Junior's at the line now and Casey Kane's at the line now. So, I mean, there's only a few cars between Casey and Junior to go a lap down. And that's the 3rd time he's been up on his back bumper.
One of them is Mike Bliss, another is Jeff Green. And then Scott Riggs. And Carl Edwards ahead of the leader.
Getting through these cars is where Casey Kane has had trouble before. He got bottled in up here, boxed in a couple of times, and that allowed Tony to catch back up and actually pass him. So they might be a little more aggressive getting through this traffic this time. He's driving very cautiously.
Well, Dick Berger pointed that out. You know, he's been asking his crew, what is his brake rotors looking like?
Jeff Burton in the singular Chevy tracking Michael Waltrip. They are 11th and 12th. We're at 280 laps. That's 70% of this race. And most importantly, we're within the window where one more pit stop would get everybody to the checkered flag. The Chevy American Revolution 400 is brought to you by Chevy, reminding you to buckle up, America, an American Revolution. We're
They're about to be side by side for the lead in Richmond. Casey Kane caught up in race traffic, and Tony Stewart is right there again.
And it's the same thing that happened to him before, Mike. He gets in traffic, Casey Kane in the nine does, and he's just not very aggressive trying to get by these lap cars, and allows Tony to catch him. Tony doesn't waste any time. He sees an opening, he takes it right like that there.
Almost three wide.
If Tony doesn't see an opening, he'll make an opening.
He drives it down into turn one, down to the bottom of the racetrack. We'll see if Casey Kane in the nine can keep that momentum in the high side of the racetrack.
No, he had to get out of the throttle. Got a little loose off of two, and that allowed Tony to take the lead.
It's as if Kane approaches traffic using care, while Stewart approaches traffic with a lot more confidence.
Well, yeah, Tony knows you can't wait. You got to make a move, man. You got to let them know you're there, and you got to get by them. If not, they'll hold you up all night.
Down to Stewart's pit and Matt.
Tony planned to head to the lap traffic, DW. He told his spotter, Mark Robertson, who hails right here from Richmond, to start working the other spotters in the spotter stand. Let them know we're the leaders and we're coming. Let them know they need to give us some courtesy.
And see, that's another element of getting through the traffic. You know, maybe they need to tell Casey's spotter, hey, go tell those guys to cut us some slack.
You know, right behind this group, just a few laps ago, we didn't talk about Kyle Busch a lot in the five car, one of our Rookie of the Year candidates. He just drove by Jamie McMurray in the 42 car for fourth, and now he's about to catch Ryan Newman in the 12 car. That'd be a battle for third.
Yeah, Kellogg's car had a great run going at Darlington. Was, again, the highest placed of the Hendrick cars, but got up and into the wall.
And in my opinion, this is what Hendrick Motorsports needs. They've got Jimmy Johnson, they've got Jeff Gordon, but they also need these other young drivers, Brian and Kyle, to help out to really get their program where it needs to be, as good as I think the Roush program is, because they got that going. Roush does.
Jamie McMurray in the 42. He's the fifth place car. And his name shows up on a lot of people's dance cards. Mark Martin retires the end of this year. Rusty Wallace retires at the end of this year. And those are two key spots to be filled. And there are hungry young drivers desirous of those rides.
And even I heard Ricky Rudd, somebody saying that he had even said, hey, I might think about this more this year than I originally thought.
Look at Casey Kane, though, in the 9 car. They kind of got out of lap traffic. He drives back by Tony Stewart in the 20. He takes the lead again.
He's much faster than Tony, but he's just not that good getting through the traffic just yet. I say just yet because we got a long way to go yet.
All right. With 105 laps to go, Busch hasn't come near to shove yet. Plenty of time for that.
And maybe Kane says, hey, Tony, you're pretty good at getting traffic, through traffic. Go on up there and get us through it, and then I'll pass you back.
You poke the hole, and I'll follow you.
Yeah.
You use your fenders up.
Guys seem to be more concerned about you being behind them than they do me being behind them.
Casey Kane moves in on Scott Wimmer and Dale Earnhardt Jr., the last two cars on the lead lap, running 21st and 2nd.
And we thought he was about to recover from that penalty, but it just don't look like it here. We got about 100 to go.
Hey.
Casey Kane and Tony Stewart have been slicing and dicing the lap cars into nice little pieces, and they've worked their way past Travis Quaffle and Scott Wimmer now.
Well, I was thinking, well, maybe Kane has a brake problem. You know, maybe he's not charging up on these lap cars and has something going on with the brakes. But I think Dr. Dirt down there, Dick, he says it. He thinks he's doing something else. What do you think, Dick?
Well, I think Casey's just being conservative, Darrell. He has come so close on so many occasions to winning one of these things. And he did talk early to his crew about the brakes, wanted to make sure he wasn't abusing them. We talked about how he'd been second 6 times. Well, he's been third 3 times, fourth twice, fifth 5 times. Eventually, he's got to win one of these things. He's got a good car, and I think he's just playing it smart, picking his holes, being cool, saving it for the end. And they got a great set of tires for this next pit stop. Set of scuffs, and they've been saving all night for Casey.
So Dick thinks Chase Kane as being conservative rather than overly careful, but now he's trying to put Earnhardt Jr. a lap down, and Stewart is right there.
Yeah, the minute he caught Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the 8 car, Tony Stewart in the 20 ran right up to his rear bumper. Looks like Casey Kane finally about to put Dale Earnhardt Jr. a lap down. Dale Earnhardt Jr. is in the 20th position right now.
Stewart's been timing these moves that from turn one, he times a run that'll get him side by side with a car entering turn three.
And Casey gets down on the bottom underneath cars and he just can't clear him. Now he cleared Dale Jr. there. He'll be good now and he'll move on.
Right hand side of your screen, we've been riding with Michael Waltrip in the 15 car battling with Jeff Burton, the 31. That's the battle for 11th position. Both these guys battled each other most of the night at Phoenix about 3 weeks ago.
Well, look right in front of our leader, Joe Nemechek and Robbie Gordon. Gordon's car has been climbing the hill and he's been running higher on the racetrack than anybody else tonight in that number 7. He's trying to keep from going 2 laps down.
Yeah, he's a. I saw him jump the cushion once.
Right.
And he recovered, but lost a lot of time.
Of course, Joe Nemechek in the Army car, the 01 car, he's fighting to stay on the lead lap right now. He's in the 19th position.
You know, I think that 9 car is a little tight, too, Larry. I think it really accelerates off the corner, which that's what a car with a lot of good forward biting and being tight would do. Looks like he's a little slow right through the middle of the turn.
Well, this is by far the longest green run that we've had. In fact, this has been about a 75-lap run. We're only about 25 to 30 laps away from what would be green flag pit stops.
And that's kind of how this race goes historically. A lot of cautions early, long green through the center of the middle of the race, and then some cautions late. Oh, got 77 up high, but I think he just got out of the groove down there. Sorry, guys.
And Travis Quaffle continues, no caution.
He was in no man's land.
If you joined us late, point leader Jimmy Johnson crashed out of this race early.
See Quaffle go down in the corner here. Carl Edwards right behind him. And looks like Travis in the 77. Quaffle just gets up too high. He did a good job of not hitting the fence.
Cars in the garage with 100 laps to go include Jimmy Johnson. The number 2 point man, 4-time champion Jeff Gordon is out. So is Johnny Sauter, Morgan Shepherd, and Mike Garvey.
Tell you what, a car that's been picking them up and laying them down on this long green run, Bobby Labonte in that 18 car. He started back in 39th position, has fought to stay on the lead lap. Now he's up there battling Jeff Burton in the 31 for the 12th position. This group is a little over a half a lap behind our leader right now, Casey Kane in the 9.
Burton gives Labonte plenty of room on the bottom. And they almost touch coming up on the straightaway.
You can ever get there door handle to door handle at the start finish line, you can normally win that race down into turn 1.
Burton got way up out of the groove, jumped the cushion, as Darrell said. Now has to clean his tires off and get back after it. Let's pick up on Ryan Newman on the right of your screen. The third place car trying to hold off Kyle Busch and Jamie McMurray.
It wasn't that many laps ago that Kyle Busch in the 5 just drove by McMurray in the 42 and drove away from him. Now, as Kyle Busch has been wrestling with the 12 car of Newman, McMurray has caught back up to this group.
But look, Larry, look in front of him. Where is he going to go?
Yeah, he got big wad up there.
Got a bunch of cars right there in front of him, but it just makes it almost impossible just to blow right by him.
Yeah, that's the same group that Casey Kane and Tony Stewart had to just slice through about 15 laps ago. While they're catching that group, you see Kevin Harvick in the 29 car back there still trying to overcome that bad pit stop a while ago on the last stop. He's pulling into the equation as well as Elliott Sadler in the 38.
All 3 Richard Childress cars in the top 15. 82 laps to go in Richmond and one more pit stop to come.
Singular virtual crew chief at our question, what is the team's biggest concern here at Richmond? Is it brakes, tires, or track position? To vote, text the word crew to 191 on your Singular wireless phone or go to foxsports.com. You'll also be entered for a chance to drive away in your own Singular 31 car. Casey Kane with 75 laps to go, leading Tony Stewart. And on our pre-race show in 10 laps, Kane, when asked the one driver he'd like to pass for that first win of his career, he said it would be Tony Stewart, the one he leads. Mike?
Third place battle with Elliott Sadler's 38. He was all but alongside the 12 of Ryan Newman for third. And he's got the 5 of Kyle Busch and the 42 Jamie McMurray. And the 16 of Greg Biffle, all part of that equation.
And you nailed it, Mike. That's a battle right there, man. They have been all over each other.
But yeah, while they've been all over each other, you made note of him, Mike. Greg Biffle in the 16 car, he has pulled right up to him. He wanted some of that battle.
Tough break for Dave Blaney. Cut down a tire, had to make a pit stop, and went 2 laps down.
Let's talk about Kurt Busch, the 97 car right there. Remember, the last stop under caution, he had the lug nut that was hung up. And right now, his biggest problem, our leader, Casey Kane, in the 9, keeps putting other cars a lap down. So if we do get a caution, he's just not far enough up to get the free pass, get back on the lead lap, and it's getting awfully late in this race.
Yeah, he's back there in 23rd place. The first car lap down is Rusty in 16th, and he's done a good job of getting by a lot of them. He got a long way to go.
You can see what a good car he has. He just drives by his teammate, Greg Biffle, in the 16. He just can't make that ground up.
And on the left of your screen, or actually a moment ago, Tony Stewart got right to the back bumper of Casey Kane, but it doesn't look like Stewart's getting off turn two as well as he was a bit ago.
I think he is, Mike, but that 9 car jumps off of that second turn. I mean, he really nails the throttle hard off the turn two.
We talked about green flag stops coming up here very shortly in about 10 to 15 laps. Dave Blaney in the 07, the Jack Daniels car, he was running in the 9th position. He had a flat right front tire, came to pit road, made those adjustments, 4 tires full of fuel. He can go to the end, but what this group here needs, Felipe Lopez, the crew chief, they need this to go through the full cycle of green flag pit stops, or caution would burn this group. They need it to go about 10 or 20 laps here.
7 car, Robbie Gordon into the fence and spinning down the track.
And that's going to be the caution that Dave Blaney did not want to see, because the caution is out.
Robbie Gordon, who drove for Richard Childress last year, jumped the cushion in turn 4, bounced off the wall, and he will be able to continue after bringing out the 6th caution flag of the night.
Yeah, Robbie's been flirting with that wall a couple of times here, and he finally got it. We just see him get in turn 3 a little too hard. Gets up against the wall, gets all that debris on his tires, and there's no control in the car. You just spin it around.
Now, what this caution does, we have about 15 cars left on the lead lap. We have ran almost 100 laps. I feel like that all the leaders will come to pit road. I think they'll get 4 tires, but they cannot have any mistakes. You can't have a mistake like Kevin Harvick in the 29 had. You can't have a mistake with a lug nut like the 97 had. It'll take you out of this race.
Well, the 9 car is in the catbird seat down there in that first pit. He ought to be able to get his 4, get out, and maintain the lead. And the way that car's been running, he should be in good shape.
A lot of laps left and only 14 cars on the lead lap. Would anybody gamble?
I don't think so. 100 laps is a long way.
You can't do that here.
Steve?
Elliott Sadler wants a drink of water. He also said the right rear tire is chattering. It takes about 50 laps, 5-0, for his car to come in. They will make a track bar adjustment on the number 38. Matt?
Tony Stewart hasn't won on the short track since 2002. Says the forward bite was okay on the last run, but he needs the car to turn better. Greg Zipinelli hoping to make the winning adjustment. Air pressure on the 20.
Casey Kane, another perfect stop. He stopped exactly where he needed to. His crew that has been flawless tonight. Let's see if they're flawless on the last stop. Kane, Tony Stewart is chasing him. He did it. Kane is the first one out.
Decided the nose on that Dodge Charger reminds me of a fish associated with Chrysler's past. It's a barracuda.
Barracuda.
And it's hungry.
Well, I'll tell you who's hungry, though, is this 9 pit crew. You can see it right there. The 9 wins the battle off pit road, not far behind Tony Stewart in the 20 car. Then the real battle was following this group. You'll see a whole clunk of cars coming here.
Ah, new word, clunk.
New clunk. Ryan Newman, Elliott Sadler, Jamie McMurray, Greg Biffle. A clunk of cars.
Yeah, a whole clunk of.
Sadler coming out, gets hit by a loose tire. Where'd that come from?
Looks like it may have
18, maybe.
From the left rear of the 18 car, Bobby Labonte's car.
But I think where it hit the 38 car, I don't think it was anywhere it's going to hurt it.
Let's get a State Farm safety update from Jeff Hammond.
Last week we talked about how fire is one of the driver's biggest concerns. With the fuel cell behind us, with the gas is capped, pumped to the front of the car by a fuel pump. Now, this is a manual fuel pump that's mounted on most of the engines that have been run here tonight. Now, you can imagine when the car slams on the outside wall, what happens if its fuel pump is knocked off? All of a sudden, it triggers a fire under the hood of the car and can get back inside the driver's compartment. Well, what NASCAR has done this year, they've made it an option to where you can change and move this manual fuel pump to the back of the car in the fuel cell area and mount it on what we call a Waterman fuel pump that is gear-driven instead of run off the engine. It's actually driven by the oil pump, comes down by the drive shaft to this pump that's mounted on top of the drive, check valve itself. It pumps the fuel up in the front of the engine. That way, if you slam it in the wall, you won't knock the fuel pump off and create a fire. But the engine does stop. Again, no more fuel going in the carburetor. Should not trigger a fire. Again, this is the one thing that most drivers fear the most, and NASCAR has made a step in the right direction to try to minimize that.
Thanks, Jeff. That pump is a great safety advance. And in case you were wondering, NASCAR does not allow electric fuel pumps for safety reasons.
That's why it has to be cable driven like that is.
64 laps to go. Will it be Casey Kane, Tony Stewart, Ryan Newman, Jamie McMurray, or somebody else in victory lane? Richmond and Casey Kane hauls him off into turn number one. Rusty Wallace trying to get back on the lead lap. On that caution, Ricky Rudd, the free pass car, and three wide, Newman off the corner with Blaney in the middle. And this is going to get busy at the front right here.
Right now, Tony Stewart, the 20 car, has his hands full of Rusty Wallace in a two. Rusty a lap down, trying to get that lap back.
With only 15 cars on the lead lap, that could be big.
Yeah, and Dale Jr.'s right there behind Rusty. They're trying to fight to get that free pass if they have to get another caution here real quick.
With 60 to go, Casey Kane continues to stretch it out. Remember, he's been good on those short runs. He's been good when he don't have to fight traffic.
Fighting for fourth, Kyle Busch, Elliott Sadler, and Jamie McMurray.
You know, Larry, you talk about traffic. It just appears to me with 60 laps to go, Kane's going to catch that heavy traffic right at the end of the race if we stay green. And that's going to tighten things up big time.
And the only car that has had any luck at all passing Casey Kane tonight has been that orange number 20.
Laps into this race. We know the tension is building. Casey Kane just ran the fastest lap that he has run in this race two laps ago.
Well, you heard Doc say that they had the best set of tires they were going to put on that car for this last run. And, you know, barring any unforeseen problems, this would be their last pit stop.
This is Kane's 47th career start in Nextel Cup. 6 second place finishes and some thirds. And on the short tracks this year, 14th at Bristol and second place finish at Martinsville, Virginia. Remember our pre-race on FX when Chris Myers asked Kane during 10 laps with, who would you most like to beat? Here's what he said.
You could beat out one person at the finish line to win a race. Who would it be?
Tony Stewart.
Why is that?
Just be nice to beat him to the finish line. He's tough to beat to the finish line. It'd be nice to beat him.
Well, they have similar backgrounds, and I'm sure that Tony is somewhat of a hero to Casey Kane. Seeing the trail that Casey has taken, it's the same way that Tony got here. That would be kind of fun, I'm sure.
Well, I know who else is a hero to Casey Kane tonight. That pit crew of his, led by Tommy Baldwin, because as Dick Berger has pointed out, they have lost no positions on pit stops.
Remember I told you about the driver that had 12 second place finishes before he got his first win? Where'd he get that win? Right here, James Harvey Hilton,
Neil Boddick, Kyle Petty, and Tony Stewart also scored their first Cup Series win at Richmond.
Casey Kane would love to be number five on that list.
Well, it'd be a lot of, it's his first win for him if he should pull it off. Plus, Dodge finally gets back in victory circle.
See the battle right here between Elliott Sadler and the 38 car, Kyle Busch in the five. This is the battle for fifth position. Looks like that 38 car is getting stronger as the night goes on.
You know, Elliott told me that they went, last year they struggled on short track so badly that they took that 38 car to Lakeland Speedway down in Florida seven times testing for short tracks.
Wow.
And it's paid off big time.
One big difference between the green flag racing after this restart and the prior ones is that Tony Stewart has not caught and passed Casey Kane as he did effortlessly earlier. Kane instead is extending his lead.
We just had talked about Bobby Labonte in the 18 car. Remember, he started in 39th positions. He stayed on the lead lap. He just cracked the top 10. He's now in the 10th position.
Steve?
And Mike, the good news for Bobby Labonte is they struggled early with the car. It went from loose to tight, but now Bobby Labonte is saying they have very good forward bite on that number 18 car.
Looks like they've made the right adjustments all night long. Steve Addington, his crew chief. And it's right where it needs to be as we have 49 laps to go.
Kind of felt like that if the 9 car really got after it, he might be able to pull away from ever. Oh, got a car around 77.
Travis Quaffle, caution is out. I'm going to tell you who this caution will really help. Dale Earnhardt Jr., the 8 car, the Budweiser car, back on the lead lap. Gets the free pass.
He's been on and off the lead lap a lot tonight.
Seventh caution flag of the night at lap 352. For the Kodak Dodge of Travis Quaffle, the former Craftsman Truck Series champ.
He just gets loose in the 3 and 4 down here, and the thing comes around with him. Just barely touched the wall. No harm done to the car. No damage to the car.
Now, it's only been 14 laps since that restart. We have 15 cars on the lead lap. I just think most of the guys at the very front of the field will stay out. Maybe some of those guys in the back will come in. But just remember, if you restart the race in 8th with cars lapped down on the inside, it's like restarting 16th. That's what lost the race for Clint Bowyer last night.
Here's who's coming. Mark Martin, Ricky Rudd, Jeff Burton.
And Larry, I think you noticed the 9 and the 20 car both were really, really good on long runs. They didn't fall off a lot, so I don't think they needed tires like we did last week.
I believe I packed my stuff up, take it to the trailer.
Best set of tires I got, what are we supposed to do? Put on the second best set?
Raindrops keep falling on my head, but that doesn't mean my eyes will soon be turning red. The cry is not for me, cause I'm never gonna stop the rain by complaining, because I'm free. Nothing's worrying me.
Nextel helps all kinds of vendors get their merchandise to NASCAR races.
The order's ready. Pick it up at the south end.
They just waved the green flag for the restart. Kane and Stewart knew they had to go because they are still out there on old tires, while all the lap down cars on the inside column, the inside row, took new tires. So this will get interesting.
I tell you who's coming, Ryan Newman in that 12 car. He cleared the lap down car of Dave Blaney in the 07. He's on a mission right now.
Watch that 9 car jump off turn 2. Look at that gap he puts between Tony and himself. That's where that car is so awesome.
Look at Kurt Busch coming back. He went 3 wide in turn 2. Now he is 1 lap down, trying to get himself up into the free pass position.
Yeah, he's got to get by the 0 car, which is right ahead of him there. When they're all wadded up like this right here, more than likely, there'll be some parts flying here before long.
You know what? We always like to talk about who that caution benefited. We talked about Dale Earnhardt Jr. I just think the more cautions, For Casey Kane, the 9 car, that's less laps to catch the tail end of the field and catch traffic.
Now, Dale Jr., he and Pete Rondo from Maine, his new crew chief, they had a little trouble communicating, and they talked about it when the caution waved.
When you're talking like this, I can understand you. If you're hollering into the mic, it's very scratchy and noisy. I can't understand what you're saying.
I know, but I lose my temper. You got one. You know what it's like.
10-4. Just letting you know that I couldn't understand you.
I'm sure. I knew you couldn't when I said it, but I couldn't say it any quieter.
I hear you, man.
So they got things straightened out. Now, Dale Jr. had kind of fallen off this race when he got his penalty and fell a lap down. But listen to his reaction when the caution came out and he knew he'd get the free pass.
Oh, yeah. All right. A little free in. It's not really that bad. It's just a little free in. And ain't really that bad off. Just a little bit tight in the center.
Sounds like a new man.
Well, yeah, but I can perfectly understand that.
Right.
He's moved into the top 15. He's in the 15th position right now. There's quite a battle right here. This is a battle for sixth position. Elliott Sadler in the 38. Greg Biffle in the 16 car. Remember, you look at Greg Biffle in 16. He's the only one of our top four in points coming into this race that has not had a problem.
Monday night is the national pit crew competition for the $500,000 bonus round. Greg Biffle's crew chief drew the lucky pill to be one of those four. A fellow crew chief remarked, he's got that horseshoe firmly implanted. They have had their luck going their way all year.
It's going your way, it's going your way, no matter when or what.
And it's just been a Roush characteristic. One year it'll be, it was the 17 car. Last year it was the 97 car. This year it's the 16's turn.
Well, I know we're watching this battle right now for six, but someone told Casey Kane 35 to go because he has stretched it out on Tony Stewart right now, almost a second and a half lead.
That car has had some really big time giddy up tonight. I don't know what engine they got in that baby, but she is honking.
Right now, Tony Stewart, a 20 car, he's in jeopardy of losing that second spot to Ryan Newman in the 12 car.
Bush almost got in the wall in turn two.
Boy, he's still trying to gather it back up.
And here comes Newman underneath Tony for second.
Boy, you got to give Newman and him credit, Larry. Last week, great run, had a shot at a win. Here he is tonight. They've got some consistency going for a change.
And once again, as Jeff Hammond pointed out in our pre-race, this is a backup car with very few practice laps. Went out and set on the outside pole. Here they are battling for second with Tony Stewart with just a little over 30 laps to go.
What's interesting about this battle, in turns three and four, Stewart willingly gives Newman the bottom lane because I think Stewart's found that his car is better now on the high side of the racetrack.
That cat, Ryan Newman, has had 18 top 10 starts in a row.
That sets the tempo for the whole weekend.
Hey, if you got a good Friday, you usually have a pretty good weekend.
Three wide coming out of turn four.
It's like, excuse me, pardon me. Oh, sorry, I didn't mean to do it. Like, can I get through, please?
But now all of these cars, other than Mark Martin in the six, they are battling for position because all of them are one lap down.
They're just battling. I don't even think they know what you're battling. They're just having a battle.
29 laps to the checkered flag. Don't go away. Caution flag number eight is waved at Richmond. Hermie Sadler's engine appeared to grenade down in turn one. Mike Bliss got in the oil, spun up and slapped the wall hard with the left side, but the safer barriers did their job and Mike is able to climb out unhurt in a crash that was eerily similar to Jerry Nadeau's.
See Hermie there in the 66 car. He blows the engine, puts some fluid down. There goes Tony, the leader, right by. Very reminiscent of what happened to Casey Kane at Dover last year. when the engine blew and he got in the oil.
Even with a safer barrier, that was a hard hit.
Kane and Tony Stewart were able to miss the oil, but the zero car wasn't.
And Kane was right behind it. So Hermie's climbing out for a tough night in the Peak Fitness 4.
How come y'all are not debating about what we're going to do?
Well, I'm debating right now. I was just waiting for you to quit talking.
Oh,
we got 34 laps on our tires. We're going to have probably less than 20 laps to go. Once again, I think those top 6, 7, 8 cars, no way. Like you said, I've got my best set of tires. Stay out, stay out, stay out.
I'm with you.
I'm staying out.
I'm with you.
Mike Bliss would have been the recipient of the free pass, but instead, he gets the free wrecker ride back to the garage.
The Chevy America Revolution 400 brought to you by Chevy reminds you to buckle up, America, an American revolution. Right now, Tony Stewart at a Chevy second, Casey Kane under caution, 19 laps to go. Will they pit, Jeff Hammond?
No, if I'm leading this race right now, Casey Kane, Tony Stewart, any of those guys definitely in about the top maybe 5 to 7 cars, maybe back to 8th place, I would stay out. I would not even think about coming down pit road unless I had a problem.
Here's what rookie Kyle Busch and his crew are discussing.
I don't think anybody will come here. Don't plan on coming.
I ain't coming, even if he told me to come.
Yeah, that's the dark side right there.
10th place car.
Yeah, you can take a look. He's got Star Wars on the hood of that 5 car. The only guy right now that came down pit road was Jeremy Mayfield, and that he was in 10th place right now. So I'm not really surprised to see those guys come in, you know, maybe like a Ricky Rudd or Dale Earnhardt Jr. They have an opportunity to put on fresh tires and maybe move up a little bit. Larry McReynolds and Darrell Walker were pointing out those guys that took on tires the last time went back to green. They picked up no position, so it's going to be tough for these guys to gain anything when we do go back to green.
And as Mike Joy pointed out, maybe a little history for Casey Kane trying to win his first Cup race, something James Hilton did here and Tony Stewart did here as well. We'll be back in Richmond in a moment.
Getting set to go back to green. Johnsonville Trivia, who has the most wins since Richmond was enlarged to a 3/4 mile?
Blue Deuce.
Rusty Wallace. And for once, the answer is not Harry Gant. It is Rusty Wallace. 6 wins. All right, on the last green flag run, Tony Stewart's car was too tight. He couldn't hang with Casey Kane. Kane's going to lead him down for the restart with 14 laps to go.
Casey Kane in the 9 as well as Tony Stewart in the 20 got a good restart. Remember Kurt Busch in the 97 car. Now he's in position to get that lap back should we get another caution.
Casey Kane has been waiting for these last 10 laps all his racing life, and the man he most wants to beat is the man right on his bumper, Tony Stewart.
The good thing about it, with only 13 laps to go, we will have no lap traffic to deal with.
Yeah, just remember, like last night, all of a sudden, where'd Carl Edwards come from? Where'd he come from? Tonight, I'm wondering where that 12 came from. But look, he's lurking there, right behind Tony Stewart.
Three former USAC open wheel standouts, Kane, Stewart, Newman at the front.
Oh, got a wreck here, all 2.
3 cars, Dale Jarrett, Rusty Wallace.
Caution is out.
Robbie Gordon, yellow flag, number 9.
And you know what? These leaders, they're going to have to be careful on this front stretch. There could be a lot of debris on this front stretch. You don't want to run over anything.
Jarrett's car is junk. Everybody else drove away. We should mention on that last caution flag, 6 lead lap cars pitted. Bobby Labonte out of 10th place, Jeremy Mayfield, Ricky Rudd, Dale Earnhardt Jr., Mark Martin, and Jeff Burton, they all have fresh tires. And let's add to the lead lap, Kurt Busch. He gets the free pass.
And I'm sure what Kurt Busch will do, he will come to pit road, he will get 4 fresh tires, because this next restart will be a single file restart with lead lap cars only to the front of the pack.
Turn 4.
Saw Robbie Gordon in the 7 car down on the bottom of the racetrack. Dale Jarrett in the 88. They just came together on the exit of the corner.
And Robbie got his left wheel on the flat on the apron and shot him up into Dale Jarrett.
It had not been Dale Jarrett's night. He was running in 30th, 2 laps down, but now His car sits on pit road as the field comes by. And we are 10 laps to go.
Yeah, as good as his teammate has been on the short tracks, Dale has been just the opposite. 97 car, Kurt Busch, he gets the free pass back on the lead lap.
He's coming in a hurry. He wants to pit before they line up for the restart.
He's actually coming to pit road right now.
And this, because we're under 10 laps to go, will be a single file restart.
Let me tell you something, you kind of have to hustle, buddy. If he gets four tires, they're going down into turn three now. He's to his pit box. I think he might just be able to get two.
Right sides only.
Right sides only. Jimmy Finney made the call right there.
Darrell, let's talk about the leaders. Casey Kane was really good on the last green flag run. Tony Stewart said he couldn't hang with Kane because his car had a push. Now, neither pitted. Is there anything Tony can do to alter what that car does to stay with Casey Kane and fend off Ryan Newman in these last seven or eight laps?
Well, that's the thing that Tony has to be careful of. Even if he got a great restart, let's say he got a run on Casey and got down beside him going into turn one, got Ryan Newman set right there that could just lurch all over both of them and maybe pass them both. So Tony's got to be careful not only to lose second place, but he doesn't let Ryan Newman get up there and win the race.
Packed house at Richmond, another sellout as you watch from our Quaker State aerial coverage. And looking down from our vantage point, some folks have left their seats, but they're all crowded around the fence. Nobody's leaving. They want to see how this turns out.
Now, Kurt Busch, the 97 car, Jimmy Finney brings him back to pit road to get those two left side tires. So he's going to be the last car on the lead lap back in 17th, but with four fresh tires.
Yeah, he was cutting it so close when he came in that first time. He had to get two and go back out and come back and get two more.
Coming up next on FX, NASCAR Drivers 360. First episode of an all-new season featuring our race leader, Casey Kane, and Rusty Wallace, Richmond's winningest active driver. That's right after the race.
Well, this is agony. You've never won. You're trying to win your first race. You've got a fast car. Every time they drop the green flag, you've been able to run off and leave everybody. But man, will they just get this thing over with?
Oh, these 90,000 fans don't think it's agony.
Well,
they think this is going to get really exciting before it's over.
Let me tell you, that young man in that nine car, his heart is pounding away right now because he cannot make a mistake. Don't miss a shift. Don't spin the tires. Don't make a mistake, and this is yours.
And how about his owner there, Ray Evernham?
And Tony timed that restart perfectly. He's going to get a run on him going down into turn one.
But look who's going to get a run on who? Jamie McMurray in the 42 car. He gets a run on Ryan Newman.
And this is what I was talking about right here.
Stewart was there. Kane had to give him enough room on the outside.
And Tony will be better on the outside. I think he can pin him down. Maybe not.
Kane's got to clear him, and he does. Casey Kane cements the lead.
He had to clear him, and he did at the start-finish line. Six laps to go.
And that was what? That was the only chance.
Whoa. Look at McMurray got sideways. Kyle Busch, the five, gets into the left rear quarter pass.
Boy, McMurray loses five, six spots in line off the bumper of Kyle Busch.
Don't look now, Tony, but you got another buddy right behind you in another Dodge. And here he comes. Ryan Newman looking inside, going into turn one. Stewart slams the door.
And Casey Kane loved what he's seeing in that rearview mirror, those two guys side by side.
What,
four to go next time.
Casey Kane does not want to see another yellow flag, what he doesn't want to see. Newman had him off. I think he had him a little sideways.
But Stewart's so good off the top in turn four, he holds Newman off for now. Four to go.
And Kyle Busch, the five car back there in fourth, he says, you guys keep racing like that, I'll be up there and race with you.
Yeah, no, Kevin Harvick slid back up there. He's in fifth place.
Bobby Labonte battles Michael Waltrip side by side. That's for eighth place. Second place. This is still a battle with three to go.
And Kevin Harvick is right there with these guys.
What Kevin Harvick and Kyle Busch are hoping is that Ryan Newman would get into the back of Tony and break their momentum and they'd be able to get by.
Where did Harvick come from?
I mean, those guys were battling, Mike, and he's been turning that car. He turns it right to the bottom. He just can't get off the corner right now.
Harvick took advantage when Kyle Busch and Jamie McMurray got together. Two laps to go.
You're right, though, D.W. The last thing this nine car wants to see right now is a caution in this last lap and a half.
Just come on, baby. Get to the white flag.
And he'll do it this time. White flag's in the air.
Once he crosses that start-finish line.
last lap of Casey Kane's young racing life right here.
And no pressure from behind.
He took over the number nine from legend Bill Elliott, who served as his mentor for a season, and now it's all his own. Off turn four, Casey Kane is a winner at last.
Boy, what a battle, though, for second and for him and for fourth.
They were poking and gouging back there for second. I'm telling you, Brian Newman was all over the back of Tony.
And here comes Tony to congratulate Casey. How could you call it? Who would you like to beat? Who's the guy you'd like to see in your rearview mirror when you win your first race?
It appears everybody's going to congratulate Casey Kane. You see Ryan Newman in the 12th pull up there congratulating.
Tommy Baldwin, Ray Everham, this whole crowd, they have had some heartbreaks, man, with this car. To win tonight, that's a great accomplishment.
And finally, Casey Kane can stop dodging the question, when will you finally win?
And you know what? He qualifies for that All-Star race next Saturday night at Lowe's Motor Speedway.
And don't forget how he ran at Charlotte last fall. He wants that checkered flag. Bring it down here. This is short tracks. This is Saturday night short tracks at its best.
And here it comes. The starter's bringing it to him. Nah, he took off without it. He stopped again. And I don't think he could see the flag through the smoke.
And look at this crew right here. Lost no positions on pit stops tonight. They gave everything they needed on pit road.
Tommy Baldwin, his crew chief, whose dad was a great open wheel modified driver. Casey Kane does an Alan Kulwicki style Polish victory lap to salute the crowd as longtime friends and adversaries, Baldwin and Zipadelli share a hug.
And the crew's on the wall. Come on, folks. Give him a standing ovation. He deserves it. He has been so close so many times.
You know, Darrell, most of those second-place finishes, all those strong runs, were at mile-and-a-half racetrack. His first win comes here at a three-quarter-mile racetrack.
I'd be just like he is. I'd ride around here all night.
He's run 400 laps. He's ready to go another 100.
He's going
to
unwind in a while.
Finally, one of the crew members came and got the checkered flag from the flagman.
You know, that's a great thing to have that flag, your first win. He'll cherish that the rest of his young life.
25 years old.
Look at Tony. Nice job.
That's great.
Proud of you, Tony. Good job, man. Give that kid a hand.
There's a winner and a champion.
Those two guys together led 385 laps of 400 tonight. Now he has the flag.
With Tony.
Well, back in 1999, you know what it's like to win here and to pick up your first win. And if you had to finish second to somebody, it was your buddy.
Yeah, that's what I leaned in there and told him. I said, the rest of them, the second one won't take that long to get. So I just told him, I said, years down the road when they talk about his first win, at least the good thing is I got the honor of being the guy that they mentioned that he had to race for the win. So I'm just really happy for him. He's long overdue. I mean, the kid's done an awesome job for, you know, 2 years now. It's just he needed that perfect tonight. Tonight was that night.
Thanks, Tony.
Thank you.
Great strong second place run for Tony Stewart. Carr picked up a push and he couldn't do anything with this young phenom. For car owner Ray Evernham, it is two consecutive trips to victory lane at Richmond. He won here in September to put his other driver, Jeremy Mayfield, into the chase for the championship. There's Jeremy sharing victory lane, and he wins tonight to put Casey Kane into the Nextel All-Star race.
The first Dodge Charger to go to victory lane in almost 30 years.
I don't know what that'll be worth to anybody else, but that's going to be worth a lot to Dodge and to that whole crowd for the first victory with that car. Look at Ray, so composed.
Steve Burns and
victory lane.
Well, Casey Kane, you were second six times. So many close calls, so many disappointments last year where you looked like you had a race won. Describe your emotions being in victory lane here at Richmond for the first time in this series.
Well, it's so awesome. It's, this whole Dodge Dealers UAW Dodge race team did a fantastic job. Pit stops were unbelievable. Everybody at Siemens, Valvoline, Stanley, McDonald's, man, this is just such a great moment for us. And I mean, I can't believe it. We drove so hard all night racing Tony and end up beating him, and that was pretty cool. So thank Ray Evernham, everybody at the engine shop, the race shop, and definitely my family, my mom and dad. Everybody in Enumclaw, Washington, you know, my grandma and grandpa, my papa, my nana. I mean, I used to tell my papa I was going to win a, you know, racing, be a racer someday, and I wish he was here to see it.
What did Tony Stewart say to you when he stuck his head in the window?
He just said that he's just great job, and nobody can take this one from me, and that he's happy to run second on my first win.
This will be a nice lead-in, by the way, to NASCAR 360, which follows us.
Yeah, well, I guess it's on tonight, so that'll be pretty cool. I don't know what to say. Everybody on this team does such an unbelievable job, and it's great to finally win a race. We're in an all-star race, too. That's awesome.
Casey, what does it feel like to actually close a win, to actually pull into victory lane, being close that many times?
Well, just to finally do it, it's we tried, we came second, we've been leading at 4 to go or 10 to go, and not got it done, and it's just unbelievable feeling to get it done. It's pretty awesome. Everybody at Action Diecast and Remington Curb Records, it's a great day.
Congratulations, Casey Kane. His first career win. Back to Chris Myers.
All right, thanks very much from the Hollywood Hotel. We should have seen this coming. Three straight poles for him, including the Busch series last night. And Ray Evernham, I remember asking him last year, who worked with, of course, Jeff Gordon, about the skills. He said, hey, Casey's actually further along than Jeff Gordon was at this stage. Finally got the win to prove it.
Well, he definitely did that. And I spoke with Ray earlier this evening, and he said he felt like they were right on the verge. And I don't think he realized how close they were tonight. But they had those cars set up where they could tune on them, and all night long they stayed on top of that. Outstanding job by the pit crew, and it's just so, rewarding to finally be sitting here watching Casey Kane win his first race.
No more second place for him. Let's check in with Dick Berger. Dick?
Ryan Newman with an incredible third place finish tonight. Fastest in practice early on yesterday, then bang, crashed the car to a backup. Are you surprised to be here?
I wouldn't say surprised. We usually run good here at Richmond, but I had an angel riding on my shoulder this race here. My grandmother passed away just recently, and I drove my heart out for her today, and I wish we could have won. Congratulate Casey, but that was my best effort put forth for her.
Our condolences on that. How much practice did you have in that car before tonight?
We got about 20, 25 laps, and just enough to feel the car out. Wish we could have got the pole. It was so close, but just a good effort by everybody at the Penske Racing Alltel Dodge, and I'm fortunate driver in a fortunate situation.
Sorry about your grandma. Congratulations on tonight. Matty?
A strong top five finish for Kevin Harvick. Some frustration earlier over some of your pit stops, but you bounced back.
Yeah, we've struggled on pit road last really all year. Not all night, just once in a while on the stops. But all in all, it was a good night for the Jim Gooden Chevrolet. Todd and all the guys, we had a real good handling car. And, you know, it's we got to put all the pieces together. We run good every week, and we just got to put together all the races. So, it's just a lot of fun to be out there and having a good time with fast cars.
You said it was a little bit like Bobby Allison's old attitude.
Yeah, I think DW said that, right? Oh, so it's all good. I mean, if I'm like Bobby Allison, I guess I'm in good company.
Absolutely. Fifth place finish here at Richmond.
Casey Kane, during the offseason, went surfing in Hawaii with Kelly Slater. He was one of People Magazine's 50 hottest bachelors last June. He's in victory lane for the first time. Casey Kane and his crew making their mark in NASCAR history here in Richmond. And you would expect the first of many more to come for the driver in the 9 car. We'll be back here in Richmond on FX in just a moment.